Twitchell's is coming in today, by the way. So I hear. Good morning. Welcome to the Opie and Anthony program on XM Satellite Radio.
Radio.
Patrice O'Neill in studio once again.
Good morning, gentlemen.
He's killing this week on this fine radio program.
Please. I listened to the replays after I got home, and goddamn, I find myself laughing. I'm like, I was just there laughing at this shit.
Yeah.
And then I listen, and I'm laughing again, Opie.
I got to tell you, yesterday's show was one of the better ones. It was just one of the better ones.
Just a lot
That's what we do. Some days we fall flat on our faces, and other days...
You wish you could just sit on your laurels and just...
No, because now...
And retire. Retire after something funny, and you just go... All right, well...
Know what sucks about this job? We know we had a great show yesterday. We were walking around yesterday at the show like, we are the greatest broadcasters in radio. It doesn't mean shit today.
Now gone, goodbye.
It's disgusting.
There's people out there going, yeah, well, I couldn't listen yesterday. I had to take a sick day. I had to take the kid here. I had to do this. They didn't hear yesterday's show.
I put that pressure on one of my favorite shows, PTI. Every day I watch it for a half hour, and I demand that they be good every day.
They must be good.
But it's only a half hour of being good. And they already have all the set material that day, which is just sports. Just comment on sports.
That's it.
Not belittling what they do, because I love those guys, but it's like... I demand that they be funny, but people listen to this every morning. They're like, all right, go blow yourself, all right? It's raining shit and this and that.
Be funny.
Be funny again differently from yesterday. Well, all right.
For 4 hours live.
Fucking guys. No
fucking half hour we taped this at friggin' yesterday.
And that's what blows about our world, too, by the way. We could have 3.5 hours of unbelievable material, right? But that motherfucker heard the 1.5 hour where we blew yesterday.
Do typing guy.
I don't feel like it yet.
I'll do it.
You guys sucked yesterday.
Right. Well, when were you listening?
I listened from 8 to 8:30. It was the most boring shit I ever heard.
You know that one of the best bits we've done since coming to Satellite Radio was the Fitzgerald thing.
Edmund Fitzgerald.
The Edmund Fitzgerald bit, okay?
Yeah.
I remember that day. That was the only thing that was good on that show.
Right.
And now that's one of those standout bits that people request all the time when we're on vacation.
But the show on the whole...
I remember that day going, holy crap, we are the worst broadcasters.
It was one of those days we won a battle but lost the war.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's how this biz is,
you know? So that day, it was 3.5 hours of just shitty material and a half hour of just brilliant, a brilliant bit.
I like watching... The Daily Show at night, which really blows because it keeps me up. And now, it used to just be until 11:30, but now Stephen Colbert's got that show.
And that's a great show.
It is such a great goof on the Fox News specialty show.
Yeah.
Like, Daily Show is a good goof on news overall, but his is a goof on Hannity... Or O'Reilly, things like that. He's got, like, the talking point segment and stuff. And he is one of the funniest sons of bitches ever.
I never watched him, man.
He really hit it. They hit it. The writers, him, his staff, everybody hit it right on the head from the opening, the big patriotic opening he's got with American flags and that smarmy look and the eagle flying through. And his commentary... is so dead on, like these right-wing, conservative broadcasters, but it's so sarcastic that that's where the humor is, and just funny as all hell. So now I'm up until, midnight watching this fucking show.
You got DVR it, man.
Yeah, but I got to see it as it's happening.
It's all about the DVR.
I'm one of those guys because I'm laying there in bed.
You get 4 hours of sleep.
I get about 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, about 5 hours of sleep a night.
What time you get up?
About 5 hours. I get up at 5-ish, quarter after.
Oh, well, I'm just guessing.
Shower the night before.
Right after Colbert, you just go to sleep like a robot. Like, you just
pretty
unplug
much
yourself.
Yeah. I do. I like, I'm done.
I got the DVR figured out to the point I can watch two shows now. Because there's so many commercials.
Yeah.
I tape one, and then I watch one live, and when that goes to commercial, then I go to DVR and start the other program that's on the same exact fucking time.
Yeah, we do that.
And I'm amazed that I could pretty much watch two complete shows in the same hour.
Yeah.
Just about.
Yeah.
Just about.
Isn't that amazing?
I'm like, commercials, what the hell is that about?
It beats the shit out of, you know, picture in picture used to be the way to do that, but you couldn't,
right.
You know.
I don't even watch shows no more.
No.
All I'd watch now, I wait for Saturday night late to watch any MSNBC special, you know, their prison stuff.
Oh, right. That's good stuff.
So from time to time, there'll be plenty of tsunami and end of the world shit on Discovery.
Yeah.
And,
gotta watch that.
And then all the sports shit, like, you know, First and Ten, PTI, and Around the Horn. And the rest is like, I'm just trying to figure it out after that, man.
That's something where I'm just homo. I don't watch any sports shows.
Why?
I just don't.
You're not a sports fan?
No, I'm not really a big...
They've really upped their game, these sports shows.
I know. I hear they're entertaining.
They're a lot of fun, though.
I turn them on, and just the jocks just babbling. I can't
do it.
How does
an ex-fucking air conditioning repairman not like sports?
It's not that I don't like sports. It's the sports shows that I cannot
get into. You gotta like those if you like sports. You gotta like those if
you're close like sports, really.
The closest,
like sports.
He likes the Yankees.
No,
that's about it.
I like the Yankees. When you know,
right?
When it's baseball season, I'll keep tabs on the Yankees. I'm not one of those, you know, stats freaks or anything like that either.
Right.
But I've enjoyed some ESPN commercials. They're funny. That's about as close as I get.
Speaking of sports, they gave what's his name 5 days for going into the stands to protect his wife.
Yeah, I know about things that happen.
No, I know. You know the
that
big story. I guess they had to do that, though. You can't start a precedent.
It's a no-tolerance policy, which I can't stand the no-tolerance policy. It's like a kid brings a pretzel to school, bites it to look like a gun, points it at somebody, and they suspend him for a week. Yeah, that's silly.
Yeah, but
silly.
That's, you know, I mean, it might be bordering on that Nazi discipline, but you know what? He did go in the stands. It's clear. You can't make like decisions.
Basis. What happened to the case by case basis? When you run into the stands because you were laying down and some bonehead throws a fucking soda at you and you start pummeling a guy that you think was him, then there's a problem.
So you're saying extenuating circumstance. This is very.
Why can't we? We can't these days. We're full of zero tolerance. What happened to case by case? It doesn't happen anymore in court. It doesn't happen anywhere. We talked about
this
it with divorce.
This is an unprecedented opinion by a white guy.
Ooh.
By the way,
I enjoy the case by case.
I've never heard a white guy say case by case.
I'm a big case by case guy too.
I've never heard this from white people before.
That, I don't like that.
Lock him up and tickle him.
A. So let's look at what A gets down the little flow chart, and he's got to go here. You know, it's bullshit.
But his wife, and I said this before even reading the fucking thing, I know his wife started the fucking thing.
All right.
I can't imagine, first of all, okay, he's in Chicago,
uh-huh.
An obscure, let's face it, obscure-ass Antonio 47-year-old Davis, right? Just a role play on the Knicks. Now, he's in Chicago. What fucking guy go, oh, shit, I see a black woman and some kids. You know what? That's probably Antonio Davis' wife. I'm a fuck with her. No.
Yeah.
He was booing. He was going, Antonio Davis sucks. You suck when you was here, you big brother. Fuda Buddha. And she goes, that's my motherfucking husband. Suck my dick. And that's his children. And up in his fucking face. This is why, like, again, you think I don't like women? I love them. And this is why I'm hard. My girl asked me the same goofy shit last night. Would you come into the stands? And no. Fucking no. Because I know you got a big mouth. And what guy just says, You're Patrice's fucking girl, you fucking... She's gonna be protective of people saying her husband stinks.
Yeah.
And that's why, that's what happened.
But you know,
he should have stayed and stopped being in love so much,
you
motherfuckers.
This is, we've touched on this subject in a different area. The movies. The movie theater, or any time you're out. If your chick starts shit with someone, and you're looking like, oh boy,
you know whose fault that is?
You gotta step in.
You know whose fault that is?
Who?
Yours.
Why?
You gotta learn how to raise your girlfriends better.
You're just gonna let your chick get maybe slapped?
No.
Or something?
My girl closes her fucking mouth, because every time I see somebody behave in a certain way, like point at a girl, I go, sweetie, this is what the fuck I'm talking about. If I step back, this particular man that you think you're entitled to talk to in a certain way will punch you through a fucking wall. You can't beat him up.
Yeah.
So if you can't beat him up, shut your mouth. Shut up. Don't ever come out of pocket with some fucking guy.
But just being a human being, you've never had that happen. I talked about this a while ago. I was in a Brooklyn movie theater. A whole row of Puerto Ricans were in there. Whole family. I mean, from grandpa down to the whining little fucking, just out of the womb, already pierced ears, fucking little Puerto Rican kid.
Who's already talking at the movies?
Oh, already yapping at the movies. And a woman who just wouldn't shut the fuck up about... It was Mission Impossible 2. Tom Cruise is on the screen.
Okay.
And she's like, oh, Tom Cruise. What I would do to him, let me tell... And we're like right there, okay. Right next to him. You reach a point as a human where your sense goes out of your head. Now, I hadn't reached that point yet because I know I'm scoping the scene out. I'm scoping it. So I'm beyond just the woman yelling. I'm looking at the whole row going, they are all together. There are men in there, probably with knives. I'm not fucking with this. My girlfriend turns around, and she had reached the point beyond, excuse me, could you be quiet? Hey, we're watching a movie. Now, she went right up to, hey, could you shut the fuck up? And the girl goes, Oh, no, you didn't.
Anthony, see, this is, just keep your story, just keep it in your head.
Yeah.
Immediately, that's your girl's fucking fault. No way she should open her fucking mouth.
But I'm like,
a family of Puerto Ricans.
I'm like Bush with Iraq. I can't just leave.
No, you can't leave.
I can't
now,
just pull out my forces.
She put you in a bad
exactly.
spot.
I don't deny that. The Puerto Rican's boyfriend turned around to me and then went, oh, you put her in battle mode. I'm like, oh, shit, she's in battle mode. My chick, you know, she's not going to fight this Puerto Rican woman. And the family now is turning around. And I'll smack that smile off your fucking face, motherfucker. That's what it turned into. And brave me had to get up. Find the usher and find another theater the movie was playing in.
Yes, you did.
I had
you
to flee the situation.
You did the intelligent
thing.
Thank
you, Patrice.
You wasn't a pussy, and as you
No, I was
out,
the biggest pussy ever.
You wasn't a pussy. That was the smartest thing you could have ever did. First of all, you should have just sat down and deconstructed your girl's mentality for saying that. Now you go, okay, you said shut the fuck up, sweetie. What was the next thing you was thinking?
All right, let's take this step by step.
What was the next thing that was going through your mind when you told a volatile Puerto Rican girl who's speaking at an inanimate object to shut the fuck up? Okay, now what was you thinking after that? What was the next step?
Next step is...
Exactly. I was thinking that she was going to shut the fuck up. Is that what you was fucking thinking? That's entitlement. And it's white girl entitlement. That shit is just like you walk. It's just like when you walk down the street and a white woman will not move to the left or the right. She stays straight a fucking head because this is her streets.
You see that?
She feels protected all the time.
Yeah.
I got to do this while she just walks straight ahead. Now, it's not confrontation. There's a sense of protection that white women have. And women in general have this protection feel.
I don't think that's a white thing.
Because that happens to me
in my neighborhood,
time, yeah.
That happens all the time, yeah. Too. But it's more of a money thing.
A black woman is not going to say, shut the fuck up. She thought of the second thing before shut the fuck up came out because she was ready to deal with the fuck up. Your girl goes, will you shut the fuck up, please? Thank you.
What?
Bitch, do you realize your fists... Or your nails got to be out when you say shut the fuck up to a Puerto Rican girl.
Nails.
She should have been standing.
Right.
Like, you know, fucking with the nail, with the
nails ready to go.
Shit.
Right.
To scratch her face when she says shut the fuck up. That is your fault, Anthony. You have to, you got to condition her to never do that.
After that situation, rules were instilled. That shan't happen again.
Well, that's happened to most of us, man.
Most guys. Let me tell you something quickly before Opie gets started. That is a situation that everybody gets into. And it is, and I wish there was something that can be done, but everyone in the theater was intimidated by that row. Everyone.
Mm-hmm.
White, black, other Puerto Ricans. It was such a loud family that you knew if you said boo to them, you were done. You were done. They were turning around and, you know, fuck you and everything like that. So why should an entire theater be intimidated by one row when everyone should rally around and go, shut the fuck up and get the fuck out because I'm trying to watch Mission
Impossible. Yeah, but when she said that, where was everybody else to back you up?
Nowhere.
Nowhere.
They cowered.
Exactly.
I watched heads disappear in their seats. I never saw people slump down so low. When they sit in front of me,
they're up. They're fucking on phone books
when there's a head in front of me blocking my view. This time, everyone slumped down so low.
Will you please shut the fuck up is never, ever going to shut somebody the fuck up. That is intimidation. That's like your girl should have been ready to
be. Calling someone out for a fight.
It's calling somebody out. I mean, and it's almost like she put your girl, this is your girl's fucking fault. She put everybody in a bad position. I'm going to tell you what she did. She put you in a bad spot. Then she put the girl's boyfriend in a bad spot because he knows, hey, you know what? I like stabbing motherfuckers to death, but I don't dislike you, dude, but you know I'm going to have to fuck you up.
Right.
And then it puts the girl who's talking in a bad spot because she cannot let a white woman say shut the fuck up and not go, uh-oh, I know you didn't, da-da-da, dilda. And if she had just did what her job is to be a demure white girl, which is to go, excuse me. I can't enjoy this movie.
Pardon. You know whose ultimate fault it is? I understand the repercussions after.
Tom Cruise.
Yeah, for being so delicious. You know whose fault it is, though? That fucking bitch. She should have shut the fuck up.
Fair enough, but that's not your training.
Right.
Hold on, I got to go to the phones. Someone's calling Anthony out on this. Dave on Long Island, what's up?
Yeah, hi. I'm on a payphone, so it's a little noisy.
All right.
But last time I remember you telling the story, they were black, not Puerto Rican. What are you afraid of?
No. Dude, I never said they were black. It was a family of Puerto Ricans.
I don't know. You're using the same, she's in battle mode. I don't remember any Puerto Ricans.
No, it was absolutely Puerto Rican because it was a huge family. I described it as a huge family.
Yeah.
To Anthony, it's like Chinese, Japanese.
Whatever. I will absolutely deny that, sir. It was a Puerto Rican family.
It definitely was a Puerto Rican story because Puerto Rican will give you Puerto Ricans will give you out. That's the good thing about Puerto Ricans.
Yeah.
They will give you an out if you piss them off. They'll go, you know, son, you know, what, you know, they'll talk to you. Puerto Ricans will talk to you because they know how serious they are about the violence and shit. You
right.
You know what I'm saying? So they will let you get a reprieve.
Yeah.
But if it's not a black girl, because a black girl would have went, what the fuck did that bitch say?
Yeah.
And her man would have tried to stop her because she would have immediately started lunging
slapping
at your woman. Yeah.
Slapping
nails. So I know
nails,
it was a Puerto Rican
those
story.
Those big-ass nails. I thought, like you said, the second it happened, I'm thinking five steps ahead.
Right.
Like, where is this going? I went into, defensive mode.
You should have.
I'm trying to figure out what's happening. And all I could figure is, if she lunges at my girl, I'm going to have to get in between. Because now that's my job. And if I even look like I'm injuring this guy's girl trying to keep her off of my girl,
mm-hmm.
he then is going to stick a knife in my side.
But that's where you plead to him. See, this is.
But you can't do it during a physical dispute. There's no pleading. It happens like that.
This is where pimping is dying. You go and plead. In pimp style to this guy, while his girls talk, I always disregard a woman in these situations. I look.
It's your own shit.
I look. This one girl, I was at a show, and she was like, "You suck. You ain't funny. Why?" And I'm looking at her man like, I'm like, "Sweetie, hold on a second, dude." Now, I explained to the crowd,
"You're appealing to the gentleman."
I said, "This is the type of shit that get good motherfuckers in fights." Now, if I cannot tell his girl, shut the fuck up. Now, I'm about 6'4", 300-something pounds. She can't beat me. The thing that she's doing is because I'm letting her do it. You mm-hmm. understand what I'm saying? Girls do what you let them do when they're la-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. So I go, dude, here's what's going to happen. I'm going to tell you to shut your fucking mouth, right? And then your man's going to have to protect your honor by fucking with me. Now, we two good motherfuckers sitting here getting ready to fight because you are an out-of-control bitch. And I had to tell this guy, listen,
a great
you have to raise your bitch correctly.
You put it on the guy.
Always.
All of a sudden, now that guy's thinking, he was thinking, this motherfucker fucks with my bitch, I'm going to fuck him up. You turned it around to where if he fucks with you, it's now his fault for not keeping his bitch in line.
In control.
Wow.
All right, let's go to the phones. John in Connecticut. John.
Patrice O'Neill.
Hey, guys, what's going on?
Hey, John.
I got to tell you this. Once you hear that, oh, no, you didn't, you got to just run because it's all bad news
from that. You got to run. He's just recovered from
you
something.
You do. I fled. Yeah.
Because I'm in college. I'm coming out of the cafeteria. It's late at night. I got a hot chocolate in my hand. Some guy bumps into me coming out of the door, and about two or three drops of this hot chocolate hits this black chick's sweatpants. She goes into the, oh, no, you didn't. Like, huge scene. Now the whole campus center is watching us.
Oh,
she grabs the full cup out of my hand, throws it in my eyes, piping hot, straight out of the cafeteria hot chocolate. But that's still not enough. Now her man has her in one of these arm locks. She's still, oh, no, you didn't. Oh, no, you didn't. Like, arms flailing, legs flailing. Like, he had to protect her from me. Meanwhile, I'm standing there like blind.
From hot chocolate.
She threw hot chocolate. Hey, that's extreme.
Yeah. But once you hear that, oh, no, you didn't, you gotta just get out of there.
Yeah, that's code for run.
Man, yeah.
All right. Thanks, John. Let's go to Jim in Brooklyn. What's up, Jim?
Yo, what's happening, guys?
Hey.
A similar situation happened to me about 8 years ago. My wife was pregnant with our first kid. We walk into a small movie theater in the Heights here in Brooklyn. And you know how women get it. She was irritable. So we're sitting down listening to the movie. And all of a sudden, two young African-American girls are sitting in the theater. they start talking and yapping away, right? All right, so my wife is getting a little restless. And I felt the same way. But what am I going to do with two girls? So all of a sudden, like halfway during the movie theater, these girls were talking the whole time. My wife just turns around and like a spit coming out of her mouth, shut the fuck up. And then the two girls, like, no, she didn't. And then I'm saying to myself, oh, shit, here we go. I mean, what am I going to do? We'll fight two girls? So when we leave the theater after the movie, the two girls are standing outside waiting to beat up my wife. She's 8 months pregnant.
Oh, man. Yeah, you don't want the after the theater fight.
No. But, you know, but in terms of the situation being the way it was, well, what was I going to do? I had to jump in between if these two girls were going to grapple my wife. There's no way I was going to let them grab her and try to knock her on the floor. But it was one of the funniest situations. But like Anthony was saying before, you just slump down in your seat and you turn around. I turn around to my wife and I said, please, it's just two girls.
I've seen brawls going on in movie theaters where a guy is sitting there and the girl says something or he says something and it's a group of Puerto Rican or black kids or something like that. You could usually shut white kids up. You really can. In certain theaters.
Not,
certain
most
places. Certain ages. In most cases.
Yeah, I agree.
But the only reason I know that is because I've seen people try. You rarely see. You see a group of black kids walk in or Puerto Rican kids walk in and they are being loud and they sit down. You don't say shit. You sit there and have your movie ruined. That's it. Because if you say something, no one's coming to your aid. I've seen it happen.
There's a way to...
could you be quiet? You shut up, motherfucker. You hear, like, from the back, and like, oh, boy.
Oh, boy, now there's a problem.
Oh, boy, now there's a problem.
First of all, this one thing that I do have to say, I guess I'm being from Boston. There's certain major cities where you do get white training. If you live in Manhattan, you get white training. Boston, Philadelphia. There's some white training going on where you deal with white people. There's some places, if you're black, you don't understand passive aggression. Passive aggression is one of those weird things that, you know, I'm sure before your girl and I'm sure before this guy's pregnant wife went to go shut the fuck up, it was turning around, looking, passive aggression, kind of.
Yeah, yeah.
You control yourself now, kind of.
Right.
And that also makes fucking, like, black girls very angry is that... And so they get louder. I bet you if you think about what happened, they got louder and louder as your girl's frustration. Because they knew that she's doing.
Well, there was other passive aggressiveness going on.
A lot of passive aggressiveness. And they get loud. Like, what you think, you're white huffing?
Other
gonna
people.
Stop me? Motherfucker, my house ain't fell down yet. You can huff and puff all you want, motherfucker. and it's like, you just got to go, yo.
All right, listen. I want to break in here because here's the real question. Brian's got it in South Carolina. Brian.
Yo.
Go ahead. Ask Patrice your question.
Patrice, man, I just want to know, how come it's like every time I go to it, it's not every movie, but it's every, like if it's a horror movie, why do the schwoogies got to act up? Is it genetic? I mean, it'll be like somebody gets killed. Oh, look at that motherfucker right there. Oh, shit.
Well, I'll tell you what it is.
Yeah, you guys like to comment, man.
We're not a...
Black people like to comment at the movie theaters.
I don't mind the comments in a horror movie because it is funny. I've heard some funny shit coming out of a theater when in a horror movie. When you go, oh, no, don't do that. I mean, you know, it's a cliche hack, like, joke. But it is funny when it's happening. And it's not an involved movie. I'm talking about a movie maybe you got to keep some tabs on the beginning or what's happening. And some bitch is on her fucking cell phone talking like everyone wants to hear this conversation during the movie.
But it's only the young cats, man, because movies are $12. Now, you get somebody like my age. You don't see black people my age. Black people my age are doing what white people do now. Yeah. Oh, God. You know,
can't
it's just
we
like
just I, sit and watch this
just
feature.
Please shut up. But it's like it's a whole culture, the movies for young kids. You go out, you spend $10 if the movie stinks. You just want to talk. You want to have fun. It's an event kind of thing. I think white people, you know, fact that you know white people will visit the theater from time to time, and it's like a quiet event. White people are just quiet for some reason. But
just want to watch the movie.
Maybe I'll take it back and I'll rephrase this. Not necessarily black. It's an age thing, I believe. Because I was a loud motherfucker at the movies, and I was fucking funny loud at the goddamn movies. But I think now as you get older, you get like.
Yeah. You're right. It is an age thing, but when I went to go see King Kong, I'm in some Jewish movie theater, and there's about five kids, had to be anywhere from 12 to 15 years old, sitting in the back. Wouldn't shut the fuck up.
White,
wouldn't
black,
shut up. White.
White kids.
Oh, white. Yeah, white little Jewish kids. But they're laughing, cell phone, yelling at the screen, talking, making jokes, wouldn't shut up. And a lot of shh, shh, shh going on from the theater. And they're like, yeah, you shut up. We're going to be quiet. Yeah, being very disrespectful.
Say what you want to say, mother.
So that was when I turned around. And I said, on behalf of the theater, would you shut the fuck up? Now, I never would have done that if they were black or Puerto Rican.
On behalf.
Never. On behalf. And I got a smattering of applause from the theater.
Fucking Anthony.
Because I knew that Jewish kids from Great Neck
you could get away with
are
this.
Not going to pull a knife out. They're not going to start shit. I could box them all.
Yeah, you assess the situation, then decide
right.
what you're going to do.
You assess
whether you're
going to
shut up or be a brave man.
You don't have any your girl got big mouth stories?
Well, we were in Philly once driving on, what's that, South Street or whatever it's called, and we're behind some really tough-looking motorcycle dudes, and they weren't going fast enough. You know how that road goes nice and slow?
Yeah.
And we're missing lights and stuff because they're going slow and starting up their bikes. They're out for a little joyride and just kind of taking in the scenery. So we're behind the motorcycles, and she reaches over from the passenger seat and decides to start beeping the horn to make him go faster.
Oh, no.
So I can relate to everything you just said.
What did
reach
you
over
say?
Because I'm like, are you kidding me? They're not going to beat you up. First of all, now they think I'm beeping because I'm behind the wheel, you know?
And you, and
I'm like, you're putting me in a bad situation here.
And you're not a pussy.
I'm not.
For completely getting as tough as you should be with the bikers
right.
as with her.
Right.
Like, are you out of your goddamn mind for doing that?
Yeah, because at that point, just like you said, you know, the next thing is, well, what happens next? They get pissed off. They're going to go to the passenger window because they think you're doing
yeah.
it.
And you're not going to go,
no,
that was this bitch that beat me.
Right.
No. I would. No. I'm like, this bitch beat the horn.
No, they're going to get right up in my my grill.
And you know what would happen if you do that? If more men stop thinking this shit. Chivalry shit and go, this bitch reached over and beat the horn, dude. He know what he would go? My bitch is goofy like that.
Yeah, it would just
and walk away.
Goofy.
This stupid bitch beat the fucking horn.
Let's go to Massachusetts. Chris, what's up?
I'm just kind of sick and tired of hearing Patrice use the entitlement excuse every time he talks about women.
Yeah. See, this is an empathizer. Sympathizer, you're the reason why life is fucked up for men right now, goofball motherfucker. You gotta learn, when I say entitlement, it's a thing that makes you think that there's a magical force around you that can protect you from different situations that makes you behave irrational. Guys don't do that. Like, you would never, like, okay, right now you're talking to me over the phone. But if you was sitting next to me on a train or something like that, and you was with your wife would say something before you did. You know why? Because she has this protective thing around her. You wouldn't talk because we're both men, and it's possible somebody could get choked. And I'm saying you could choke me. I'm just whatever. We can fuck each other up. That's why we don't come out of our mouth to each other. Now, the superior physical person in this situation, which is the man, why don't we come out of our mouth to each other? Why don't we curse each other? Why don't I look at you and go, what the fuck? Yo, dude, why don't you shut the fuck up? You know why? Because we are in charge of physicality. Women aren't. They go, why don't you? I'm going to beat the horn because he's not going fast enough in my fucking world. This is what I mean by entitlement, dude. It's frustrating. You got to understand, you haven't raised as many women as I have. You're not a father.
Daddy Patrice.
Yeah, you're not a good daddy. I'm trying to tell you, man. You got to get that off your mind.
Huh?
You act like the black Dr. Phil.
Well, hey, don't get mad.
I like
you,
that.
You enjoy Dr. Phil. Why enjoy the black one, motherfucking shit?
Hey, I like Patrice's, you know, view on the world.
Is he more qualified than I am? He just got a couple of papers. I'm too lazy to go to school and get validated. But the word entitlement, I might run it in the ground. I'm not fucking Captain Dictionary. That's the word I use, and that's the word that I embrace. Entitlement, man. You got to understand that it's your fault, and guys like your faults for us being in spots where you can get beat up by a biker, stabbed by a family of Puerto Ricans, smacked in the face by some dudes. You got to tell your girl, look, if you're not going to fight, if you can't fight, if you're not going to whoop this guy's ass in your own mind, in your own credit, shut your mouth. Shut up.
All right, let's go to Frank.
There you go.
Let's
look
go to Frank
the
on Long Island.
Hey, how you doing, guys?
We're going to try to move on because we have so much to do today. Frank, what's up?
Just wondering, especially you guys coming from Long Island, have you guys ever made the mistake of going to a movie theater the night a black movie premieres and you don't know what's happening?
Oh, fuck. You know what? I'm going to go do that now. I'm going to go do that knowing I could give a shit about the movie just to experience it.
Experience the whole thing?
Yeah.
It's
because I can only imagine now.
Absolute culture shock. You walk into the place is fucking mobbed, it's a zoo, and for the first time in an upscale Long Island movie theater, there are security guards everywhere. You don't know where the hell they came from. It's insane.
It is a little weird going through metal detectors at a movie theater. That's a weird thing to have to do.
Oh,
absolutely.
Where am I going? Take your shoes off, please. Could you run them through the metal detector?
I am absolutely going to do that now.
Good luck, Hope.
Good luck.
Good luck, bro.
No, I'm not going to go there, you know, hoping to see a good movie. I just want to see the theater and how it reacts. All right, we got to move on. It's raining stuff. Holy shit. Hallelujah. It's raining stuff.
It's raining things.
That was...
Anthony made a video. Well, like a quick little flash.
I made a quick little
flash thing.
Quick little flash thing. Yeah, where it's just Patrice walking down the sidewalk with, like, heavy hardware falling from the sky as he's singing, "It's raining stuff. It's raining things." I listened to the replay yesterday and was... you know, I mean, I'm here for when it's happening, and I'm laughing. Then I listen to the replay, and I'm just laughing my ass off.
I told the boys to isolate this. We got to play it again, but we need the big setup.
The big setup.
The big setup again.
It was, we were watching or listening to clips of American Idol, and there's a bunch of, you know, faggy guys, and there was one exceptionally faggy guy, looked like a woman, looked like a girl, and he decided to sing a girl-oriented song. This has been done. Guys have sang girl-oriented songs, but you always got to change the girl-oriented part to make it guy-oriented. If she's saying "my guy," you have to sing "my girl."
Right.
Things like that.
Perfect
but
example.
This guy didn't care. He just was singing a song about being a queen and on his knees, and it was just... He didn't care about changing the words.
I got the thing that you need. My pussy's wet. My titties are full. Stick it in me. I'm the queen of the night. Oh, yeah.
I never, ever thought it could be done, but It's Raining Men, one of the gayest songs ever. I've never even heard it attempted by a man because it just cannot be changed.
It's a great song
into a man's song.
Right.
But it was done here yesterday by Patrice O'Neill.
Yeah, Patrice. yeah, did the song. Why is Danny Bonaducci on TV?
Change the words
arm?
Around
when Child Stars fall.
Maybe we
can along.
Get this audio because
Leif Garrett just got arrested.
Yes, yeah, so now the guy talked to all the old Child Stars that have been in trouble.
Wow.
But why is Danny Bonaducci, he has a broken arm now?
Oh, jeez.
I thought he cleared up all his
probably
problems at the end
something.
Of that celeb reality show on
VH1. His wife probably mouthed off in a fucking movie theater.
So anyway.
He's trying to get his shit together.
Patrice off the cuff yesterday decided to sing It's Raining Men, but of course he's not going to sing It's Raining Men, so he's changing the lyrics, so it makes sense that a man would sing It's Raining Men. And he came up with this.
It's raining stuff. Yeah. Hallelujah. It's raining things. It is all wet out here. It's wet out here. Rough and tough is wet outside. It's raining things. Oh.
You gotta change the words to this. Wow.
It's raining stuff.
Let yourself get absolutely, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's raining. Oh! Hallelujah! Oh! Ow! Ouch and ooh! Watch out, motherfucker! Zoo! Wrong for Jesus! He was a bad motherfucker! Woo! And he had to do what he had to do!
Nothing about men!
Rearrange the sky so that each and every brother can get out there and do... Woo! It's raining stuff. Oh, it's raining things. Uh-huh. Watch out. Shit is flying around. The fuck was that? Some heavy shit flying around. Watch your shit. Watch your shit.
There you have it from yesterday. That thing just makes us laugh really hard.
That is a hit. That's a hit song.
It's raining stuff.
It's raining stuff.
It's raining things.
It's racist.
It took the gayest song and just made it where every man can now listen.
It's
every man
stuff.
Can now sing that song.
Oh, yeah.
And not worry about their sexuality.
It's raining just some shit falling from the sky, whatever it is.
Heavy shit.
And I'm going to sing about it.
Well, Anthony did a quick little thing. It's up on opiateanthony.com. You just see Patrice and,
God,
and stuff
damn.
Is falling from the sky. And it just says across the screen, it's raining stuff, hallelujah, it's raining things.
God damn.
Very good. The other thing from yesterday, and man, our listeners are quick. We love
Jesus.
Our listeners, absolutely.
Amazing. You must have millionaires. You have to have entrepreneurs that listen to the show, like, because it just happened yesterday.
Yeah, you know, and they have the equipment, the means to just,
God.
Like,
the one thing people,
record.
When they do talk about this radio show, they talk about how interactive this program is and how, like, the listeners are really, really involved with the radio show.
Oof,
like,
man.
No other show out there. I mean, we allow the listeners to become stars, basically, on a daily basis. And yesterday, we pulled a new bit out of our asses, and it worked, and I think we're going to do it again down the road. We were taking a look at the top country songs in America. And we had a lot of fun with that yesterday. And then we, like, started goofing and singing a country song called With Clean Hands. You want to set this up,
another
too?
Another making up the friggin' song shit that was going on.
Basically, we don't know country music whatsoever, so we got the top country songs in America. We got the title of the song, and then we all had a discussion trying to figure out what the song was about.
And then we play the song, right?
And what was With Clean Hands? What song was that about, remember?
Oof. It was the number six. It was the guy.
Dierks Bentley?
It wasn't Dierks Bentley. It was somebody had a duet with, it was the guy. Remember the guy you said... You said it's just a love song where he goes, the good looking dude that I said he could sing. I know which one it was.
Where's the list from yesterday? It'll be easy if I see the list. What song it was?
Because you listened to that and then the Dolly Parton duet came on
right
with the guy, but it was the song before that and the Dolly Parton song that.
When I get where I'm going.
Dicks.
No.
Where I get where I'm going.
Oh yes, that's it. Billy Currington must be doing something
Billy
right.
Billy Currington.
Right. Thanks guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Must be doing something right. So we're thinking, what could that song possibly be about? And we went off on a tangent about how the guy must be clipping his nails before he goes in
because he's got a chick, he's getting a chick, his life is falling into place, he must be doing things right, and yeah, figured it was, you know, because it's country, he probably just cleaned his hands before he touched his woman's genitals.
Her vulva.
Her vulva. Volvo.
I know. We said vulva like
and,
a few times.
Yeah. With clean hands.
So with clean hands, he's touching her vulva, and that's what he's doing right.
And that's special.
And that's what we guessed the song was about. So we had fun, and you guys, I think it was Anthony mostly, was singing his version of...
It was a duet.
Oh no, Patrice was in it on... yeah. And you guys were going back and forth doing With Clean Hands as a country song, right? Well, the listeners took it upon themselves overnight to come up with country songs called Clean Hands.
They always do.
We got two of these in. We didn't even ask for these.
I think these are well-produced or something, too. Jeez.
Yeah, they do a good job.
So the first one is by DJ New Style. Listen to this.
I wash my fingertips and I trim my fingernails. I light a candle and I whistle and wait for you to come over and put me through hell. Bedroom door bursts open. There you stand. I try to show restraint despite my swollen gland. But oh, I'm gonna take my time, slowly rub it right. I'm gonna lay you down and touch your vulva with clean hands. Don't need no finger grease with clean hands. I'm gonna touch that pretty crease with clean hands.
Could be a country song.
Gonna rub your little cooter with clean hands. God damn, you stink, but I got clean hands.
That could be a country song.
It's DJ New Style.
As country as anything.
It's no different than anything we listened to yesterday.
Isn't that great?
Sensitive, tells a story. Guy washed his hands for us.
Just going off a little something we were talking about yesterday.
Yeah.
And then we got another one from Anthony Sanchez from Vegas. His clean hand song.
Always sensitive, these songs, because you're taking time out for the girl. You're washing.
I didn't think it could happen to me that I'd actually care about hygiene. That it might be wrong leaving grease on your thong when I'm digitally trying to enter your gas. It ain't the trash, and it ain't no place for dirty fingernails. My hole gets ivory soap, and I'll do my best to remove the smell with clean hands. And I didn't blame, didn't care about the stink when I dirtied up all of them vulvas. And I never cared, wipe my dick with their hair when I kick them all out of my mobile home, that is your gas. It ain't no trash, and it ain't no place for dirty fingernails. My hole gets lava soap, and I'll do my best to remove the smell with clean hands. No more hangnail hysterectomies. No more handheld that is infecting me. No DNA from hookers spraying piss on me. Radio is free and so is HIV.
Jesus.
I didn't think
epic. Fucking epic.
That I'd actually care about hygiene and clean hands.
There you go, Anthony Sanchez from Vegas and his clean hands song.
That's a hit song, man.
almost sounded like it had a little bit of that didn't it a little bit?
A little bit, yeah.
So,
bravo to
that's unbelievable. It's like a real song in like one day.
Yeah, they took it upon themselves to kind of go with it.
Clean hands.
We love when that happens.
With the twang.
All right. Twitchells is here. We haven't talked to Twitchells in a while. He's going to come in and help us out, I guess. I don't know. I don't know what the hell we're going to do with him today.
Yeah, we usually have him come in with Big A.
Right, but Big A.
But where's Big A?
He couldn't make it today.
What is he? What could he possibly
his
have
job.
To do?
His job, probably.
He's fucking on him, man.
Maybe we could get him on the phone. I don't know.
Jealousy. Jealousy. That's what it is for me.
Yeah.
Eric from Kentucky, what's up?
What's going on, man?
What's up?
Hey, man.
Hey, man, I want to tell Patrice, man, you're telling the damn truth with the damn ladies, man. Entitlement and shit, man. Fuck what that white boy said.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Hey, man, Man, I got XM a week ago. I ain't even listening to music yet, man. I've just been listening to y'all. Y'all crazy motherfuckers.
Thank you, Eric.
Thank you, Eric from Kentucky.
Tell your friends about us, all right?
All right, man. Y'all spreads. Can get into trouble. Peace.
All right, there he goes, Eric from Kentucky. Cool.
Noticing a lot of people, man, coming on board. A lot
Absolutely.
Of people from a lot of places around the country.
That's why we call it a virus. It just slowly but surely is spreading across America.
It spreads. It builds.
It's the ONA virus.
We get on... And from the time we got on, when we were two pieces of shit that had been fired for 2 years and pretty much exiled to the radio trash pile, people had their doubts, Opie.
Mm-hmm.
But now it is building and growing, and you could feel it. You could feel the people, that there's a lot of fans out there. Unlike somebody, let's say, who is at the top of their game, and then, you know, years later, you end up on satellite, and you have a big push, and then where does it go from there?
Where does it go down, I guess?
It just goes down. It's not a building thing.
And we still want to do five, you know, days a week of radio.
Yeah.
And we work more than 9 months a year.
Uh-huh.
Wait till that story comes out. Love to see how he's going to spin that one.
I actually was going through the channels last night, and VH1 had private parts on. You know, I believe me, we've stated enough times how much I cannot stand fucking Howard Stern. There are some funny-ass parts in that movie, god damn it. Paul Giamatti's hysterical. And I rewound and played that when he knocks the carts over onto the record. But then you just got to watch the parts that you know is bullshit. And sensitive Howie. And then how self-centered and egotistical do you have to be that he had to transform himself into the Howie from 95 when the movie came out, the look, years before in actual history he looked like that. Where was the fat little Afro-Jew Howie with the big walrus mustache that he had up until like 1985? They had him at like DC 101 with the long hair, trying to be the cool Howie, years before he was there. A lot of inaccuracies. They also played it at the same time. It was on the Sci-Fi Channel. No, nothing?
Nothing. All right. Well, we'll break it. We'll continue. We got to talk about Star Jones when we get back.
Mm-hmm.
She's at it again.
Talk about entitlement. Holy shit.
Wait,
this woman thinks the world should be delivered to her on a silver platter every single day.
Wait to hear what she has to say about Osama bin Laden.
Oh, is that a news tease? Wait till you hear what she has to say. We'll tell you after this.
That's right. Let's say hi to Tom in West Virginia. Tom, what's going on, man?
Yeah, I just want to tell you, I like the guy stuff. I just got my XM like 4 days ago. My boss put it in my truck. You got some dedicated listeners. I'm in New Mexico, stopped at a truck stop in the morning. I'm a trucker. Went in to go to the bathroom, you know, and I'm sitting down. I look on the walls, and I see Opie and Anthony in the morning written all over the bathroom stall walls, man. I just wanted to let you know that's how dedicated your fans are. They're willing to take this stance to let everybody know where you're at.
Well, that's part of the marketing campaign. The truckers took it upon themselves to write messages in the bathroom stalls for us.
Well, I'll tell you what.
Because they all have the XM, so it's a matter of turning them on to the channel.
Well, see, if you would send us some promo stickers or something, man, we could stick them everywhere.
I kind of like the underground thing.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
We like the grassroots thing. That's why we call it a virus. Slowly but surely, our listeners do things to help us out. So.
Well, hell with it. I'll just call Uncle Vic and get me a pen and go to work.
All right. Thanks, Tom.
All right. Appreciate it, Buff.
All right. There he is. Tom in West Virginia. All right. Star Jones in, I wouldn't call it in trouble. She's just showing her stupidity today.
And she's done it so often that people just accept it.
Do you ever watch TV just to be pissed off?
Yeah, I've done that.
I search out The View almost on a daily basis to be pissed off.
Annoyed.
Because these are the dumbest broads on TV. Absolutely
stupid. They're tackling
the
hard-hitting issues of the day.
The only one that's worth watching is Joy Behar. She's very funny, and she doesn't give a shit, and she's just all about having fun. She doesn't take herself seriously. The rest of these women think they are the smartest women in America.
They just stick to, like, talking about tampons and making coffee. Maybe. Right? Right, men?
They just do psychobabble about the dumbest
Anthony.
Shit.
Second they start talking about politics or anything that really has some substance or makes a difference in anyone's life, that's when they get into trouble.
Well, the Post is telling...
Talk about shoes, girls.
Yeah.
Yes, talk about shoes.
Talk about something you know a lot about.
Yeah.
Well, the Post is telling Star to zip it. Somebody tell Star to zip it.
Uh-oh.
I say let her talk, wow, man, because it's entertaining to me.
Harsh language.
I start yelling at the TV and all that crap. You watch TV to get mad, Patrice, ever?
No.
No?
No, no. It that's redundant. You know what I'm saying? You just watch it and something will make you mad.
Something
you watch
will piss
the news.
You off.
Something, yeah.
But a lot of people, if they see something that's pissing them off, they'll turn the channel. That's when I start really focusing, and I don't know what it is. I like to get pissed off at the TV.
I have a hard time watching things that are cringeworthy. Like, not so much things like cringeworthy on this show, but things that you're watching and go, oh, you're
like
embarrassed.
American Idol?
You're embarrassed for people and can't watch. No, that I can. Like maybe one of these touching moments.
See, Lindsay's like that.
I go like, oh.
Lindsay's like that, has to cover her face and stuff. And I'm like, no, man, this is great. I love when people make asses of themselves.
Yeah.
I love cringe TV. I love cringe stuff in general.
Can't turn away, but it's pretty rough sometimes.
Like American Idol, did you feel for some of those people when they were just making fools of themselves?
Yeah, but that I enjoy. I really enjoy that.
Yeah.
The greatest show in the history of the planet was that show on WB that had people think they can sing.
Oh, yeah.
That was great.
It was the greatest show I've ever seen.
I'm so surprised they can't somehow bring that back, like find some rubes who don't know that actually was.
They could bring it back, Anthony.
Yeah.
You got these asses in Hollywood. Oh, see, that's not. Oh, you really shouldn't do that. You really shouldn't do that to people.
I still remember that one guy that was on there. Remember, he was going, yeah, yeah, no, no. Like, he's saying, yeah, yeah. And the judges were all phony and in on the joke. We're like, could you add a few no's into, you know, your riffing like that? He's like, yeah, sure, I could do that. Yeah, yeah. No, no. He looked, it was so ridiculous in one of those embarrassing moments.
Yeah.
Because he was really serious. He thought, you know, he was on American Idol. So that's nothing.
That was a great show. And it was all about making fun of people. Oh. And you just can't make those shows these days.
Because everybody thinks they could be a, like in this game or something. So it's good to see a lot of people just get bashed right in the top of the skull trying to come and singing and dancing. And
what was that show called? Can they sing or something like that?
No. America's Superstar.
Next Superstar.
Yeah, Superstar like USA?
Superstar, yeah.
What's the name of the show?
Okay. Genius show. Genius.
Yeah.
Anything that isn't American Idol, it's like, have you heard anyone come out of anything that isn't American Idol as far as a singing show goes? And there's been a couple of them that
they've
thrown on.
You've never seen anybody that's come out of anything on TV that's tried to make someone a celebrity overnight, man.
Yeah, the reality shows. You
really don't hear it from American Idol. If you think about it, it's just one. Kelly Clarkson's the only one really that's out there.
Well, Carrie Underwood. Clay Aiken is making a
fortune. She's got the number one country song in America.
I feel what you're saying, but, you know, it's that's the newness of it, you know what I mean? But it's like when I see a guy like say, Bo Bice, right? I go, this guy should quit right now so that he can have a career. Because the dude is, I think he was like one of the best singers. He was just great, a great performer, polished. But he's on that show, and you don't hear from Bo Bice as much as you should. And, and his edge is gone because he's an American Idol. So the edge he needs to really make it.
It's taken away by
taken away
the show that made him a star.
Exactly. He's an American Idol.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Well, let's get back to Star Jones. So
Star Jones.
The View, they were talking about the Osama bin Laden tapes that were released yesterday.
New tapes yesterday. Some of them making some, it was a smorgasbord of ideas. It seems like he'd been away for so long that he hadn't been in touch with us in a while. And he kind of threw a bunch of stuff into this tape. I like when it's just Osama going, I hate you. Allah hates you. We will continue trying to kill you. Whenever we get the opportunity.
But in these tapes, he's hinting that he might want a truce with Uncle Sam.
Now it's all about, like, pulling out. Now he's got, like, exit strategies for us, and he wants to maybe negotiate on some kind of peace scenario in at least Afghanistan.
I think he's sick of getting bit by spiders.
Running, just running.
He wants out of the goddamn cave.
All that money he's got, and he lives in fucking bugs are crawling up his ass every night.
He's getting bit by spiders every night in a cave going, man, I have $1 billion I can get my hands on right now.
He's got three ragheads whose job it is just to pick the bugs out of his beard every day when he wakes up. Right. Pick the bugs out of my beard, you
And he's 8 feet tall, so you know, he can't even get up in the cave and stretch.
How hard?
I was telling Anthony.
The second he comes out of the cave, they just have, like, predator drone things set for 8 foot guy.
Yeah.
Like, any 8 foot guy it sees, it just blows up. So he can't even leave the fucking cave.
And he's a man. He's a guy. He's a person. You know what I mean? So it's like, these motherfuckers, these anxious motherfuckers are like, you know, okay, what's today, man? What's today or something? And he's just like, oh, what? I got to. Can I not take the medical? What? It's fucking Monday, my friend.
Looks like someone has a case of the Mondays.
It's fucking Monday, my friend. Martin Luther King birthday, my friend.
Osama, I am here as your soldier to do as you command, to kill the infidels. I've not even had my coffee. I've not even had my coffee this morning, and already, Ahmad, you are here to bother me.
Doing the thumb and index finger over his eyes. Oh. What? What?
Yes, we still hate America. No, I am not losing my passion for Islam. But one day.
I think old dog's getting weak, my friend. No, don't you ever say that. Don't. Look at him. He's picking stones.
He tells his boys that he's going to take a three-day weekend.
Allah, hear you. You will surely be turned into a pillar of salt. Not speak of him in this way.
He's probably trying to grow shit up in the fucking mountains in Afghanistan. It's like, I'm trying to grow a tomato. It's just like a tomato garden.
You think at this point he's thinking, it seemed like a good idea at the time. Fuck, man.
You know why?
This
is in terms we can understand and what we've been talking about. In terms of celebrity, he's not quite as big as he was right after the bombing. That was like his big... Oh, he's wanted, but he's not as big as he was right after his biggest performance.
Yeah, that was in Zeppelin 4.
Yeah, that was
huge.
That was the Black Album. That was it.
Now he's like fucking the band Boston.
All right, well,
we're just sitting here waiting for his next album to come out.
And he gave us Cool the Engines. Thanks, Boston. Jeez. Maybe you guys could have, like, you know, got together a little bit more than an hour before you made that third fucking album.
On the list of horrible motherfuckers, is he in the top five, maybe? Is he going to go down in the top five?
This guy is definitely I put him at number two.
Well, you can't put him at number two.
You got him.
Well,
Hitler's number one. He'll always be number one.
Mussolini's number two.
No one cares about Mussolini. He made the trains run on time.
I put Slobodan Milosevic above
Osama. We don't care, though.
I go with Idi Amin.
You're talking
Idi Amin's
world.
In the top,
you're
in
talking
the top
world, then. You're not talking about how Americans feel about these people.
About
I'm talking about how we feel.
Fair enough. Hitler's number one. On the planet. That motherfucker's the Elvis of fucked up motherfuckers. I guess Osama.
He's the king of terrorism.
Oh, well, I'm killing all the Jews. We're going to gas them Jews. We're going to gas them.
Oh, my God.
Well, so just. Let me kill some Jews. You can do what you want, but I just want to kill some Jews.
The king of evil.
Oh!
Yes. The Elvis.
You can do what you want. Oh, shit.
Too good.
He's the Elvis of
Blue Suede
evil.
Jews.
Blue Suede Jews.
So Bin Laden did this latest tape.
Oh, viva Auschwitz! Viva Auschwitz!
He's just the Elvis of evil. But yeah, Osama's just number two.
With his audio
tapes.
Okay,
fair enough.
I don't know how history might put him. You know, later in the years that go by, perhaps he'll drop in the ratings, but
he's up there for now.
He's up there. That, you know who's trying to really grab on is that Al-Zarqawi guy. He's trying to really Mr. Head Muckety Muck chopping off heads over there in Iraq. He's trying. He's vying for position.
I think he's always going to, as long as Osama's around, unless he does something to Osama, he's always going to be...
Second fiddle.
Yeah, he's always...
Yeah, but it's like the mafia.
The basis.
He wouldn't mind, you know, taking him out.
Yeah, Osama's
Because he probably thinks he's in the front line. He's in the trenches, and Osama's just
he's
making
like
tapes.
Big Paulie Castellano, thanks, Osama.
Sir. Osama's probably then, like Big Paulie, yep.
And then Al-Zarqawi's like Gotti.
Like Gotti, yep.
Yeah. Just waiting.
Yep. Yeah, I think you're right, too, man. Mm.
Can you imagine Osama living his life, though, wondering if this is the day that one of his guys close to him is going to rat him out?
Every day, the tension
like you
and
said,
pressure this
no matter what
under.
You think, this guy is a human being and what's going through his head on a regular basis.
And with the rewards that are out there, like they're all living in shit to protect this guy, and they know if they turn him in, it's a palace. It's...
Wondering if today's the day they find the cave or,
yeah.
You know.
I think they would have did it by, I mean, it's, what is it, up to 50 mil or some crap
yes.
like that?
But you got to think that they have to know where he is.
But anybody that knows
with all
where
the people
he is
around,
is on the list.
Yeah.
Anybody yeah, but then those people on... have people, like, they communicate with. They, not one person slipping up and going, guess what?
But they're all
he's
terrorists.
Up in this hill right behind me here.
Mm.
Yeah, but it waters down eventually. Terrorists have friends that aren't as much terrorists. And they have families, and that guy's...
There's a...
I'm just saying, there's got to be...
Here's a chain, right here. Here's a chain of linking Osama bin Laden to us.
6 degrees of bin Laden?
It's, yeah, 6 degrees of bin Laden. He was in front of a camera or in front of a tape recorder taping his latest statement. That had to get to Al Jazeera.
Right.
Somebody that... was with Osama bin Laden, had to physically take the tape and go somewhere.
Right.
No,
why can't we get the NYPD?
You think they're emailing?
You can easy do this. This is. I mean, you know, I think a little paranoid ways of just doing things, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think that you can kidnap somebody,
uh-huh.
blindfold them, drive them the 17 hours up to the Afghan hills, give you a tape, you know,
yeah.
drive you back. Give you that, say, you give it to da-da-da-da, and those people are sympathizers, and they'll just give it to Al Jazeera and not even know.
I do not know, my friend. They took me blindfold.
But that's the story the news should be doing is, you know, how they got that tape.
Yeah.
Well, we got it from this guy. Well, yeah, do the drug thing.
Find that guy.
Do the drug thing.
And then find out where he got it.
And
find out where he was.
Wait. Can you think, motherfucker, they can't even trace... who bootleg transported to in Chinatown. You think they can fucking, like, find... They cannot find that person.
This is a little more important, Patrice.
I'm just saying.
Transported to.
They want, it's big. They want it just as... It's costing money. In this country, things that cost money, you know, is just as important.
Two guys. Take two guys. Put them on each side of the door at the Al Jazeera building. And look for some suspicious-looking guy with a fucking videotape in his
hand.
Yeah,
then you grab him and go, where'd you get that from?
Where'd that come from?
And then he'll tell you, and then you go to that guy.
Well, you don't think they thought of that already? Not saying that you're not a genius, Anthony, or Opie.
But why
you don't think they thought of that shit?
But the news should do the story on this. Like, you know, why they can't trace this tape to anything.
He comes down, he's the tape, my friend. And then he just walks away, and they go, okay, follow him. He just walks. They follow him for 6 months.
There's some...
Nothing.
Some tea joint.
Right.
Nothing. Because they're busy kidnapping another person.
Dibber-dibber-dibber-dibber.
Well, Nino's got a good one here from Jersey. Nino...
Yeah, what you need to do is send Dirk's Bentley and say that.
I'm new mission for Dirk Bentley. We must follow the videotape guy and find Bin Laden.
And here's another conspiracy theory.
I'm Donald Brooks. Good to see you. I am head of intelligence with the CIA. We're looking for the Bin Laden tape.
Donald Brooks. The most American fucking name.
Dick.
Could you name the guy a German fucking name in one movie?
Really? Yeah, just a few syllables. Make it a little believable.
Anthony Stevens, pleasure to meet you. I'm here on a grave, important espionage. Where's the Bin Laden tape?
All right, so everyone's discussing the latest Bin Laden tape. And,
yeah.
And he hints on this tape that he wants a truce with Uncle Sam.
Some kind of truce.
And, you know, intelligent people aren't buying that horse shit.
No, the American government was very quick to come out and say, we don't even negotiate with it. This is not even in the realm of possibility.
Right.
Go fuck yourself.
So that's the one thing about this, I like this country for a lot of reasons, but that's one of those things, those precedents that I really do appreciate is that they don't negotiate with terrorists. If you are caught, you are in deep shit.
You think behind the scenes, some kind of covert little maybe chat with someone's going on?
It's possible.
Happened
but,
in the Iran Contra.
Well, we do illegal shit like that.
Sometimes you kind of. We're not directly negotiating with the terrorists. We're negotiating with this guy.
Well, we need
who's
a drug.
Negotiating
we need a drug.
With.
We need a yeah. drug dealer land to
intermediary,
fly
right?
Just to fly planes. But I mean, I think it's you know that's the one of the best things that because I think if you negotiate with them,
oh, it's
then
over.
That means it's just everybody's just going to start doing
that's
fucked up shit to it.
Money in their pocket, right there. They know yeah. how. Then they know what they got to do to get us to fold. To kidnap people, chop their heads off, and then we'll give in.
Well, here we go. Star Jones, stupid. This is what she had to say about the tapes.
Now, if you're the president and you hear this audio tape, particularly if they prove that it is his voice, what do you do with that?
I'm annoyed that he's still around to make audio
tapes.
Well,
he is. Maybe. We don't know. That's annoying.
The audience. She's
They're
annoyed.
My heroes.
Wow, that's really going out on a limb. I'm annoyed.
And they don't even hear. It's just that there's a rhythm. I've been doing comedy forever. You can really brainwash audiences. You just have to have a certain rhythm. Just say nothing but go, oh, some, you know.
Hey, I got to interrupt for a second. Mike from the Bronx. NBC did describe how tapes get to Al Jazeera.
Really?
Mike?
Hey, what's up, fellas?
What do you got on
hey
that?
Hey, Mike, what do you say, Bill?
Hello there, you beautiful mocha prince. Okay, car crash.
You really want it? Jesus ain't taking that wheel.
Go ahead, Mike.
They had a system of 25 couriers. They would pass it over the course of 8 to 12 weeks. That's why every time they have the tape, it's referencing news that's 2 or 3 months old. They said a lot of times they might kill a couple of couriers just, you know, scare the other ones into keeping their mouths shut.
Wow.
So it's really hard to infiltrate.
Can you imagine your pick to be a courier? Like, oh, no. Come on, man.
Thank you for this honor.
Oh, come on.
Imagine. Take this, or you're fired.
What?
You're going to kill me anyway.
Yeah, you think your job sucks. Can you imagine? You're pulled aside. Guess what your job is today? No.
Oh, Sama has made the tape. It must get to Al Jazeera. We have one tape that is his. 10 decoy tapes. All decoy tape couriers will be killed. Oh, you shit. Do not know which is authentic tape. Take tape.
Pick a tape.
Okay.
Oh,
please.
Oh, let it ride on me. Mother love.
No whammies.
Big money, no whammies. And stop. Oh, you stopped on a tape of the 1968. NCAA championship.
Oh, my
damn it.
God. Pick a tape. Okay.
Okay.
Hold on. I might even be able to help you out.
Okay.
Okay, pick a tape.
Hold on.
Very nerve-wracking. Okay, pick a tape. Make it Osama tape. Osama tape. Nothing bad. No death. No decapitation. No shootings. And stop. Oh, stop on whammy. Oh, no.
Oh, that's fucking genius. Oh, the tape. Oh, which hand is it in? Behind my back. Everybody pick a tape.
But he got this.
Oh, big money.
Oh, wait, you got this.
Next courier. Oh, do I have to? Okay.
You need a spin?
Yes.
All right.
Okay, I feel lucky. Osama, I feel lucky. pick a tape. Okay, make it Osama. Make Osama bin Laden lay this tape. I take it to Al Jazeera. No whammies. No whammies. Please. Please. I need good Osama bin Laden tape. And stop. Oh, no. It's not bin Laden.
Oh, my God. Oh, my goodness. Which one is a real thing?
That's
got
to blow.
Yodel-oo.
What was that on the price?
Okay.
Okay, we are going to play Osama Tape Blinko, where we drop 10 tapes down, and your name's corresponding on the bottom. Oh, no.
That's a good idea. Osama Danza.
Oh, boy. What is tape number 5? Oh, Jesus.
Oh. Oh, my God. He gets it. Oh, my goodness. The Courier game.
Yeah, that's got to be
big
awesome.
Money, big money.
Big money, no whammy. Accurate tape. Accurate tape.
That's great. All right, let's get back to the view and these dopes.
Right.
Star Joan especially.
I mean, sir, but beyond that, let's say it is his voice. Once you get beyond being annoyed, what do you do if you're the president with that information?
I think you investigate it, and then you can't give it too much weight. I mean, if we gave that much weight to every single threat that came through, we'd be in a lot of trouble. You can't just open up the land and give it to Osama bin Laden so that they can then use that to train troops and then really attack us 4 years down the road.
I agree with you.
That, by the way, is the right answer. That is the only answer.
But now I'm only thinking of Patrice going, blah, 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 blah.
That was from the chick that used to eat bugs for Survivor.
Really?
Yeah. That was the right answer.
Oh, the dispensable one.
Absolutely.
The one that they replace every so often?
Yeah, the young one.
Yeah, the young one.
That doesn't deserve an opinion. That's how they treat the young one on that show.
Yeah.
You're too young to actually have a real opinion, but we'll listen to your cute little opinions.
And no one listens to
you. You ain't been through what I've been through, honey.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Your snatch ain't dry yet.
I think that...
Yeah, that's real cute there, blonde girl, but I was a lawyer, and I know.
And I married a faggot.
I married me a faggot and lost a bunch of weight. And I think I look good, but my head looks like a stretched out milk dud. Oh, she and her eyeballs.
Holy
fuck. I don't know what the hell is going on. She looks like one of those deep sea fish you pull into your boat and like the pressure that they're used to living. Yeah, it's all eyeballs.
Yeah, because the pressure.
Because the pressure that
they
used to live. They used to living under the pressure to keep them all intact.
What do you call her? An anglerfish?
An anglerfish.
Big angler.
Got a big swarm in front of her mouth.
Star angler girl.
Star anglerfish. Mm-hmm.
Looks like a black frog.
They're always wet, like a wet, like. Bulldog eyes she's got.
She lost all that weight.
Oof.
Oh.
She looks like she's melting.
Yeah.
And then.
Oh, that's cute, girl, but let me tell you my opinion.
But I just want to say, and...
Mm-hmm.
Here we go. More mm-hmm. from the View girls.
I tell you, love, why would you trust this man?
He's given us no reason.
But I don't trust him, but I would, anything that gives me the opportunity to seek peace, I'd at least check it out.
This Osama bin Laden seems like a reasonable man. I think we ought to negotiate.
With who?
He said he'd let us go.
With who? We're not at war. Like, we're not at war with Osama bin Laden. It's like, how do you negotiate with, like, he's not, he can be like, look, we don't. I'm not in war with you. I'm just doing fucked up shit to you. How can you negotiate?
He's a criminal.
That?
He's a criminal. It's like negotiating with a murderer or a bank robber. Like, all right, we'll let you go.
Just don't negotiate.
Yeah. All right, watch the Road Warrior, and watch the scene
where the people, where Humongous goes, just leave the oil and walk away. I will give you free passage through the desert. Just walk away. And people in the compound are like, okay, it sounds all right. Let's do it. Guy's asking to negotiate. The second you try to leave, what happens? You got dune buggies and motorcycles and crossbows on your ass.
Humongous.
Humongous. Lord of the wasteland, Humongous. The Ayatollah of rock and roller. Humongous. Big intro.
Great fucking gag. Humongous. And that's what
keeps
Osama
his,
is,
keeps
baby.
His vicious guys on leashes.
Humongous, baby. That's Osama.
Humongous.
It's humongous.
Warrior of the wasteland, Humongous.
All right, more Star Jones. It gets better here.
But he's made it very clear that his goal, the goal of his organization, is to destroy America. He's made that clear.
Well, he says that we're the devil.
Right.
And but you know, people make deals with the devil all the time.
But if your plan is very clear.
We make deals with people that we don't like. I mean, we made deals with Saudi Arabia.
That's right.
We don't like their human rights.
But they have not come out and said our plan, our goal, our mission is to destroy you.
But they
figured
it
clear.
But he's also figured out that it's not working.
Maybe he changed his mind.
You know, I mean, and honestly, I think maybe we changed his mind for him. We changed his mind for him.
So you think you negotiate with terrorists?
I don't think you negotiate with terrorists, but I do think you figure out whether or not there is a solution that is diplomatic that does not result in
anything. But you know
what? Do we have to lose to check it out?
That's right. Checking it out is fine.
This isn't a deal. I mean, this is more, I read it. It seems more like an ultimatum than anything else, tried to, in disguise of a deal. I mean,
I don't believe in the ultimatums, especially from him.
Oh, my God.
Oh, Jesus.
What a babbling ass.
She is actually considering a dialogue, diplomacy, with this animal. There's no diplomacy. Oh, well, we negotiate with Saudi Arabia. Yeah, we have trade deals with them. Yeah, they're ruthless motherfuckers over there. You steal something, they'll chop your hand off. Yeah, a little adultery going on. Who knows what they do? Gouge out your vagina with a spade shovel. You know, they're pretty uncivilized over there, but they are a sovereign nation that we deal with. We deal with China. One of the human rights in China, it's an abomination over there, those people. And we deal with them. We go there. We smile with their leader. Or Bush smiles, and they forget about the heads being lopped off. And
we get the panda bears from there.
Yeah,
the cute panda bears.
The cutest little panda bears. They look like they're wearing little masks.
That's the biggest problem. Is these
and they're adorable, and they are ruthless. But they figured out they have stuff we want. And we have stuff that they want, and they're willing to exchange money over it. If terrorists came out with the next big thing that Americans loved, and we actually had a trade deal with them, all would be forgiven. What do you think? We loved fucking Japan after World War II? You think all of a sudden we went from shoving a flamethrower in a cave and watching their barbecued asses come running out so we could shoot them? We went from that. And a couple of years later, you know the type of hatred it takes to fry someone with a flamethrower and then shoot them as they come running out of a cave? That isn't, well, it's my job as a soldier. You hate that motherfucker. You hate everything having to do with it. A few years later, we're buddy-buddy because they're sending cars over here. We're sending them iron. There's money being exchanged, and it's profitable. We hated Germany. Same thing. Now we're buddies. Why? All of a sudden our ideology is the same. We put our arms around each other. We like swinging pewter steins back and forth to march music. It's all about trade and money. And what can you do for us? What could we do for you? And how much money can be exchanged in the process?
I don't know. I don't feel like we're going to like be, you know, in cahoots with Osama. I don't know.
We are with Saudi Arabia. Is what I'm saying. And that's as close as we are right now to being in bed with Osama.
Yeah, but he fucking hates Saudi Arabia.
He hates him because of that they're in cahoots with us
as
far as business
goes. He hated him before that, though. He just hated him anyway, dude. He's like...
He feels like they sold out Islam and...
He just hates them dudes. He hates... He hates fucking Saddam, who we should just put back in office.
Yeah.
Just put that fucking guy back in office.
I'm all for that.
There was no insurgents when that motherfucker would go in your mama's house and throw her head through a, through one of those mud houses. It just, why did
one
we
of his
fuck
sons,
with him?
One of his sons want to fuck your wife, and you stand up to him. The next day, firing squad for you. You think there's going to be insurgents in the day? You think there's going to be bombs on the side of the road when the Iraqi army comes through?
They constantly disrespect this country because of our goofy movies, because they just really think that we really are, like, they can do that speech. That whole thing, I have rights in this country. You can't just hit me. You can't just kill. They don't believe that we will go do something so horrible. And the Japanese will tell you.
Arrest me then. I will be out in one day, back on the street, fucking your women.
It's always that scene in the movie.
He screamed like a stuck pig. What you say? I said he screamed like a stuck pig. Now you remember that infidel when I beat the rap.
And he pulls the gun. He pulls the gun out, and his partner goes, "Don't do it. It's not worth it. It's not worth it."
Yes, put your gun away. You will not shoot me.
All right, well, you got to hear the last clip from Star Jones. This is the one that'll piss off a lot of people today.
Maybe we shouldn't make those movies anymore.
No, man.
Undermining our shit.
Watch how Star Jones simplifies the whole thing.
All right.
It could be a way to save face. You know, Bush is looking for an exit strategy.
I don't think he saved face with him personally.
Remember in the Cuban Missile Crisis when Kennedy made a deal behind the scenes and said, we'll take our things out of Turkey, blah, blah, blah. Something like that has to be done.
But at some point, one of these men has to put it back in his pants and zip up the zipper. At some point, your husband has to do it. Osama's not a president.
I don't think this was about somebody whipping it out. Do you think that all of our problems is about that?
No, I mean that metaphorically.
I know, but I don't think all of this is about that.
I'm a little tired of posturing back and forth. You know, you guys are the devil, so we're going to destroy you. And then
that's posturing.
You know, but
that's exactly
Osama,
what he thinks.
He can't destroy us. If we really wanted to, we could make that whole place a parking lot. Right. Everybody knows that.
That old gag.
Make it a parking lot.
And then what do you do? Who wants to park there, you dumb
bitch? Who wants to park all the way over there?
Will there be ferry service across the Atlantic? Hey, look, man.
Are we going to be shuttling people across the pond? I'm not in complete disagreement with
what just came out of her fucking mouth.
Really?
That's how we can do it. And it will be fucking Mick Alaland, and it'll be fucking trains and fake rivers. And if we decided to do that, man, remember we dropped the mushroom. We set the precedent with what we will do a motherfucker if we really feel like it.
But what we're saying, we're sick of hearing make it into a parking lot, because then what?
We go there.
You know what the
it's
age
hot for over
what?
There.
For what? There's one giant parking lot.
We ain't using that.
Before the radio, you could have helped put in the air conditioning system over there and fucking nice hotels.
First of all, we ain't never using that A-bomb again.
What do you do?
We are never going to drop that bomb again. Just because we did it in the 40s, that means nothing. It's like, you know what the atomic bomb is to us now? It's like Amos and Andy. Yeah, it was there. But you sure as shit ain't seeing it on TV today. It's so politically incorrect to nuke people.
But it's politically incorrect.
It's worse than any kind of racist TV. Al Jolson will hit the stage sooner.
Hello, my baby. Hello, my honey. Hello, my ragtime guy.
Are you saying Al Jolson should drop the bomb? If it gets dropped, it should be dropped.
Just drop it by Al Jolson.
I'm going to drop a bomb.
Should fly over with a big nose art on the bomber of Aunt Jemima flying over the... We'll never do that again.
But that's what kept us in the... that particular move kept us where we are today.
Right, the muscle men. Look what we did twice.
The fear that we would do that. And again, I mean, World War II, the whole Japanese thing, it's like, remember, man, those people were just as frightening to the country, the kamikaze motherfuckers, that whole idea that this gook's going to fly his plane into me and don't give a fuck. Don't forget, it's like we dealt with that enemy. That horrible, oh my God, enemy before.
But the problem was they were centralized, had a leader that if the leader said, all right, the jig's up, enough of this, they stopped. They stopped. They did everything for their emperor, and when that was it, dropped a couple A-bombs, they decided to stop. There's no, like, one guy. Even if we get Osama, and he says, stop, we get him on TV, please stop, no more terrorism against U.S. It wouldn't stop. There's so many different cells and factions. That's why this is, the whole war is weird. Doesn't work like the old school wars where we're bombing their capital right now. Where's the capital of terrorism land? Ain't no capital. We'd have nuked the shit out of it. We would have pulled out a nuke for that one if they were all here. We live in terrorist land. It's like one big city. You know, they all live there. They do their terrorism shit and then come, honey, I'm home. You know, suburbia.
You got the call. From who?
Yeah. Mike in New Hampshire's got a great observation. Mike, what's up?
Yeah, I think that the nuclear bomb is much like the C word in a stable marriage. You always get it in your arsenal, but you ain't never going to use it.
Yeah. But you use it to do what? So that is the last resort.
Right.
But if your wife is, if you had known to say that to her once, and it crushed her in terms of like, it was a crisis and you said, you fucking cunt. And she just went, oh my God. Mm. And you got through it. She probably won't get you to the point where once she knows you'll use it, she's not going to fucking fuck around with you. Yeah. She's not going to try to invade Cuba no more. If you said it.
But you don't want to desensitize that word either. You want it to always have the punch, so you can't use it at will.
Right.
You must use your traditional weaponry.
Yeah, we can't do it, but if things got ugly, really ugly,
yeah,
we're known to use it. That's all I'm saying. That's what's keeping China in line, is that we are just known to do fucked up things.
Yeah, that's got to scare the crap out of other nations. I mean, if it was China that had dropped two A-bombs back in the 40s, we'd still be going... They did drop two A-bombs. Yeah, so I think you got to...
We're still nervous. It's like, okay, it's like on 9/11, those planes, like it's almost like you go, when you was 10 years old, if you had a bully, and the bully punched you in the face, hit you in the face, and then you're 25 now, and he's still threatening to punch you in the face. He's not going to punch you in the face. He just keeps using the fact that he once hit you.
Right.
And it fucked you up until you kind of go, you know what? These some pussy-ass motherfuckers. Now, they thought we were pussy-ass motherfuckers on 9/11. That's the whole thing, because we really are on this level. Mm-hmm. I got to get my footnotes. We are, because our country's not about, like, hardship. Our country's about somebody trying to live right, make money, go in the pools, get some pussy, drive a nice car. That's our thing. But now you made terrorism a part of our thing too.
Yeah.
So there's nothing else you're gonna be able to do now. You're not gonna be able to fly another plane into a building. Because the reason I truly believe this, the reason it happened the first time is because of movies. Because they thought we was gonna land in a... We're seeking asylum. We're landing in Putunga, and we have asylum. You will be let go. And then they did that fucked up shit.
Yeah.
So they fucked it. They did the only thing. It. Once. It. That's it. They can't do nothing else no more. So these tapes, he knows he can't do shit no more. What else can they do besides grab a couple of people over there who's trying to build buildings in Iraq and grab them up?
Yeah, they're grabbing the wrong people too.
I mean, it's working for me. It worked for you. Don't have to cut a head off for me not to ever go to Iraq.
Yeah.
Like Colin used to always say, hey man, why don't you come? And I didn't make no bones. I'm not going to be peer pressured into getting my fat fucking head cut off.
Oh.
I'm not going over there to entertain nothing.
Colin's head looks bad enough. Imagine it on a pipe.
On a goddamn
on a
pipe
stick.
With that half closed eye and half fuck that
smirk on his face. You know. I ended up here.
This what you get for being trying to be sarcastic with the fucking... I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Hold on. Let's go to Peter in Massachusetts. Peter!
What's up, guys?
Hey.
Hey, Patrice, I agreed with you yesterday when you called that girl a cunt, but today you have no idea what you're talking about, so just shut up.
Okay, well, Talk to me.
Maybe you can explain a little more, elaborate that.
Don't just call me a dumb nigga and then just that's it, motherfucker.
That's
just
it.
Fucking let me know where I don't know what I'm talking about.
What's the problem?
Yeah, I'm punching out.
Wow, he had nothing.
Wow, okay.
He just decided
he
to
called
just call
you
me.
Out and had nothing.
He just called me stupid.
Oh, I like the guy that said that line 7 is gone.
Yeah, they all went away.
He's the one that said that Star Jones thinking is like the lawyer guy in Die Hard, or actually the office worker guy. Hans,
you know,
Booby,
you know
I'm your white knight.
Genius. That was fucking genius.
That shaking, sweating, piss his pants guy.
I'm not saying anything that's saying. I'm not agreeing with her on in her context is different than mine. But I'm saying that you know this country. We're not. People think we're just these pussies. This not. We gotta understand. It is what it is. Don't get offended for the fact that our country does some fucked up shit. And I like that about us. So don't get like extra. On this American thing, when you know we do a couple of things and we're capable of doing shitty stuff, man.
A lot of the stuff we do, I'm not talking war. I'm talking things that piss people off as far as trade and environment goes in this country. And there are a lot of people that get pissed off. A lot of people that say that the reason we're hated so much around the world is because of our arrogance and the things we do. But usually, for the most part, those things that we are doing are for the best interest of the people in this country. You know, it's like we try to do as much as we can to make the country that place that you can get the pussy and the cars.
Fair
and you
enough.
Drive on
Fair
roads
enough.
That aren't full of holes and friggin' bombs.
Because it does trickle down. I mean,
yeah.
I don't think they're doing it for us, they're doing it for them. But if they're doing it for them, they can't just go, okay, I'm going to pass a law where I can just get pussy and you can't.
It's very hard to not start with the very wealthy and they're the best off.
Right.
And then have it trickle down
right.
to the very poor and they're the struggling ones. But, you know, any society through history, no matter how you concoct it, has always had that hierarchy that's run through it. But what we do is trying to make this the place, the place to live on the globe is America.
And it is. It's,
yeah.
it's the place to be.
It really is.
I love talking shit about America because it's just a part of what it's a part of what you can do.
Yeah.
You can't just be in Iraq, some Iraqi comic or Iraqi radio guys. Oh, what's with the size of fucking, you know, the Arab version of Star Jones? That fat, but do you see how long her face that's covered up is? Holy shit.
Yeah, there you go. That's a heckler in Iraq.
Jacob, D.C., what's up?
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Hey, Patrice, I'll tell you where you're going wrong, man.
Okay, go ahead.
You live in Manhattan, right?
Yeah, fair enough.
And you don't think anything of going downstairs to get a slice of pizza or anything like that. This country's great. People live here because it's free, because you're not scared, dude. But, like, think about it. In Israel, you go down for a slice of pizza, you never know when you're going to get the shit blown out of you.
No, yeah. No, I agree with you, dude. I agree with you. Yeah, I just say.
Yeah, you never said anything.
Yeah, you got to understand. I love this country. It's just that, you know, we got to understand, you know, that we're not, you know, this is not
the reason is you get people, other countries, that get very upset with the fact that this is kind of, you know, pretty cool place to live. A lot of shit going on. They hear from people that have been here or live here, and they get a little angry. You know, and then you get the religious fanatics who think everything we do over here is against their God, and they
right.
want to destroy us. It is always about our way of life
right.
and how people can't stand it and want it to end for some reason because they're not involved in it.
Right,
I think there's a lot of jealousy going on there.
I mean,
you know?
I'm spoiled. I'm not, like I said, if somebody was like, go back to Africa kind of thing, it's like I'm leading the fight to stay because
no.
that Africa is not the Africa that I was... You know, where I was the king and the queen, and I had the queen, five women here, and my dick is hanging out, and fucking go get me some pigs, and whatever the fuck they used to, you know, that whole Shaka Zulu shit, beautiful bitches with some titties hanging out,
yeah.
that shit is gone. And I don't even know how to live over there.
It's fucking ripped jeans, Nike shirts, and machetes now.
Exactly.
That's what's going on.
That's the new Africa. Let's go to Big Dick Eddie.
Hey, morning, boys. How's it going?
Good. Make it fast there.
Hey, Patrice, I'll let these crackers throw you off track. I agree with what you're saying, especially with the bullies. Except in Anthony's case, you need to insert Boomer Esiason in there.
All right.
Yeah, see, but I was still all intimidated by Boomer.
George, Rhode Island.
Bully motherfucker.
Ramon, get me my atomic bomb so I can nuke these sand niggas. Ramon.
Basically, what he was supposed to say is drop the politics, get back to the funny. All right.
Ah. I thought our politics were funny.
Yeah, there was some funny in there.
Yeah.
We'll take a break. We got to get Twitchell's on the show.
Drop the politics and get to the funny. Like, motherfuckers
really.
Yeah, like we were serious. You saw that bit on fucking Wolf Blitzer. He was playing the Courier Osama tape fucking no whammy bit.
That's why I'm retiring.
No bad tape. Make it Osama tape. Please. And Osama tape. Oh. Oh, no. I landed on 1969 World Series.
That's what I'm quitting comedy. I'm quitting, so I have to look at the crowd, you know, for five. You got to make them laugh every 6 seconds.
Yeah.
Can I have a moment for, can we talk politics?
Can we have a moment, please?
We're reasonable, intelligent men. Hey, let's have a little intelligent comedy. Try to. Hey, and it's like, oh, man, shut up, motherfucker.
Pops into your head and you want to just blurt it out, can't you, without some idiot.
All right, after this, we'll do something maybe funny. Who knows? On XM Satellite Radio, Patrice O'Neill in studio. He's playing the Helium Comedy Club in Philly, like all next weekend. I need tickets, by the way, for your Thursday show.
Real?
You know, I'm not going. I got Philly friends.
No, I'm saying maybe there should be an ad on the channel that you're going to be playing there. I haven't heard anything about it.
I am so sick of hearing, hey, Big Beard, what's up?
That's what you
hey,
get.
Big Beard.
That's what you get for trying to make me fucking be
look at
be
you trying to relate to the
comedian.
Philly guys and their stupid
like
beards.
All the other guys, like the Bill Burr who can get in there and rattle off a plug and Bob Kelly. Well, Bob Kelly.
What Steve should do is make you guys do like
hysterical.
Four or five versions of the promo so we can rotate so it stays fresh.
I'm going to say
I'm sick of you talking about the beards like you, like your buddy with the hey, cha-cha.
It was just a shout-out. Yeah. I might
shout
change
out to
it.
The beards.
Just because every time it comes on, I'm sitting here and my asshole starts to fucking.
You got to listen to yourself.
He's up on me and
did you hear Bob Kelly's?
No.
He cannot speak or something. Do you have it?
No, I'm not sitting there.
Yeah, listen to this.
Hey, what's up? This is Bob Kelly, or Rob Kelly, or Robert Kelly, or Bobby.
He's uncomfortable in his own skin, this guy. I love it.
I'm going to be at the Tampa Improv, February 9th through the 12th. This time I'm actually giving you the city. Did I just say actually?
Steve doesn't help either.
The number is 813-864-4000. Call them for tickets. Again, that is 813-864-4000. Tampa Improv, February 9th through the 12th.
Listen
check
to the
out.
Music.
It sounds like a chuck
Steve is a dick. He puts Fred Albert over my shit. Boom, boom, boom. Boom, boom, boom.
A love line.
He's controlling the mood of these fucking things, man.
He goes,
hey, Big Beard.
This time I'm actually give the city. This time I'm actually give the city.
Yeah. But that's not even all the audio.
He played low self-esteem music.
Yeah, I played low self-esteem music. I let these guys tread water in front of the mic for about 5 minutes, and then I cut it down to about
a minute. This is where this show is different, because we know that's all just horse shit, so we try to, you know, jazz it up with the Fat Albert music and all that crap.
Oh, that was fun.
Boom, 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 boom. Hey, everybody. Hey, Big Biz. Boom, 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 boom,
boom. Baby Don Patrice O'Neill.
Boom,
boom. And, of course, all that's added after you leave the studio.
Oh, I'm like, hey, Big Beers.
I can do that to your
imagine
face.
If I do that. Hey, Big Beers out there in Philly. What's happening, man? It's Patrice on boom, 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 boom. Hey. Fucking. And then Bobby's low self.
Hi.
This is Bobby. I'm not sure if I'm funny or not, but I'll be in.
Yeah, cancer hospital review.
Fucking hospice. I'll be at a hospice.
Hospice.
But there you go. Steve does that to you guys.
Steve's hilarious.
By the way, all these guys, absolutely hilarious when they hit the stage. when they're not doing our radio show.
Oh, yeah.
Got to say hi to Gavin. He's in studio today.
How you doing, guys?
We just like having Gavin around. He's a big old old guy that can kick anyone's ass.
So are we playing High Stack Tourette's out there today?
He only comes to
bed. That's what I've come for. I've just seen
Gavin always
Twizzles.
Shows up when Twitchell's or Big A show up.
Is he drinking coffee now, or is he drinking
Yeah, we could
Red
get
Bull?
Him in here real fast.
Yeah,
so
we got
out.
Him drinking a lot of coffee.
The guys, Danny and, was it Danny, Nathaniel, you helped out with that? These guys, we're always trying to figure out what we can do with Twitchell's.
Because usually Big A is in with Twitchell's. They make a good team. They're like Bud Abbott and Lou Costello, those two.
His job. His
Did Big A lose his job?
No. They're giving him stress.
He's at a funeral or something like that.
Oh, I'm sorry.
But Twitchell's
delivering the eulogy as the body rots.
And he was...
Come on, the embalming only lasts so long, Fatso.
He did heckle that.
Oh, I'm sorry, that man. That's awful.
People didn't know him. Like,
I stuck by him. He's the best, man.
Tragedy.
Well, listen, there's a lot of people that got their XM for Christmas and the holidays and all that, so they don't even know who Twitchell's is yet.
Oh.
He's our friend. He's a comic that has Tourette's. What's up, Twitchell's?
Legit.
How you guys doing? How was your New Year's?
Really good.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Pretty good. Hey, did you see the HBO special on Tourette's, Kids
with
Tourette's?
Yeah, I did, actually. I'm a member of the TSA, and I was
what's the
very
TSA?
Aware of the video.
The Transportation Safety Authority.
No? The TSA is the Tourette's Syndrome Association.
Wouldn't that be the Y-TSA?
Oh, my God. You should be beeping that. That's fucking... That's just so...
Why are we letting him sit?
No, is it my fault? I'm sorry. I just thought I could see you better.
Twitchell's, you're not allowed to sit. Yeah.
I'm doing
what they're telling me to do.
How did everybody get so evil just now? We're on the radio. It's like, when did you get a seat? Like,
fucking Tourette can't sit.
We only let the black guy start sitting on the big guy. I think we're going to let you sit?
They told me to sit.
You haven't performed enough yet for us to allow you a seat.
Stand your screeching ass up.
Look at me like I said, chuck him out of there. What's he doing?
What the fuck, dude? You know.
Well, I got
and
headphones.
And then move his chair to the corner. Yeah. To
yeah.
We're not.
We got no ideas.
We're not stupid. If he starts sitting, it might calm him down a little too much.
Right, and he crosses his legs.
You're on this show for one reason. That's to twist your ass up.
Once he stops, hey, fellas, you know I'm cured. Get out. Fucking tries to bash his head against the wall. Wait, fellas, wait. Now it ain't Tourette's anymore. It's just retardation.
Hey, at least I get headphones. I'm happy.
There you go. Are you drinking Coke? Are you drinking, what are you drinking there?
So far I've had 4 cups of coffee. This is, cups of coffee. This is just my first cup of water.
So this is just the time scale thing again.
We got him addicted to all the coffee and the Red Bull and stuff. So.
Drink alcohol?
Hey, I won't do Red Bull again. I won't do that.
No. Do you drink alcohol?
Yes, occasionally.
So, calm you down, right?
Yeah.
A little bit. So you saw that special?
Yeah. Did you guys see it?
Yeah, I tuned it in there. I was hoping, you know, sorry for a few laughs, but it was actually very good and very sensitive and nicely done and
cool.
Pissed me off. I was hoping for just, you know, a bunch of guys like you cracking jokes.
Well,
and,
the thing is, less than 50, everyone says the same thing, why don't you curse, you know, as much as you should? And I'm like, well, you should. Less than 15% of those who have Tourette's actually have the cursing, which is coprolalia.
That's great. The lucky people with Tourette's. You can have Tourette's, which is rare enough or just, like, bad enough, or the Tourette's that make you an outcast of society where you curse.
Anthony, I want to ask you this. If you noticed how some of the kids who were performing or doing something, like the one kid was playing the piano, the Tourette's didn't bother him as much.
Oh, yeah,
he was focusing
like,
on
went
something.
Away.
Exactly. That's what it's like with me when I do stand-up and when I'm acting.
I had a drummer years ago with Tourette's, and when he played drums, he was fine.
He was fine, right?
Fine. And then, like, in between songs, you know? Yeah, exactly.
Oh, gotcha. Hey, you did a comedy show recently, Twitchell's, and it sold out because of the radio program?
I tell you right now, if it wasn't for you guys, it really completely shocked me, the response it got. Not only did it sell it out, they turned about 50 or 60 people away, and the majority of the audience was O&A
fans. Our fans are very supportive. live.
Oh, my God. They were awesome after
They're
the
amazing.
Show. It was funny because after the show, they were actually quoting from past shows that I've been on, quoting me and stuff. And it's just, I found it really, you know, thrilling. I really appreciate
that. The show's a lifestyle. Right. It's not a radio show anymore.
just to come down and watch this motherfucker. Spasm.
In my defense, I got to say something.
Shut up, no defense.
Hold on, Patrice. I got to say this. A fan walked up to me after the show, a fan of ONA, and they walked up to me and said, I got to tell you something. When I listened to Patrice, and Patrice was saying earlier on the show, this is when I think either the first or second time I was on, they were saying how Patrice was saying, I'm almost like Carrot Top using the Tourette's as like a prop. And you know what? First of all, I live with it, so it doesn't go away. Yes, I can manipulate it and try to control it as much as I can. However,
special episode of shaking. Shut the fuck up, nigga. I don't want to hear your fucking...
But anyway...
About what your fucking fans said to you. Yeah.
But no, I just thought it really...
Twitchy motherfucker.
Hugh said to you that Twitch has something serious
to
say.
No, it's not serious. I just thought it was really cool that they knew it wasn't
Let's go to
bad.
Josh in Philly. Josh, what's up?
Yo, guys, how you doing? Happy birthday, Patrice. Twitchels, you better jump out of that fucking seat, you dumb hump.
Hi, how are you?
Get out of the seat. All right, we're gonna make him jump. So the guys came up with a great idea for Twitchels today. Yeah, Danny, was it your idea?
Oh,
both of yours? Danny
now they're all going to try to take credit.
Well, come on in and explain what you want.
I want to know who blurted it out first.
This is great. Just when we thought we ran out of things for Twitchels to do, these guys came up with a pretty good idea for today's program. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, it's Danny and Than.
Wow.
He doesn't get old, does it, man? He does not get old, man. I love it.
Wow. That was a
twitching lunatic.
And we're going to have to do some betting a little later. For the new listeners, you know, let the new listeners try to win some money today.
Let's take some fun bets and things.
All right, what do you guys got?
All right, well, Dan, we were
go close to the mic.
We were trying to figure out a way to get, obviously, do something with Twitchels, and Danny said, well, he needs to not move. We need to find some way of him not to have to move. And I said, what about the board game Operation?
The board game.
Wow.
You're speaking English now. What about the board game?
Yes, the English accent.
It just needed to be something where he had to concentrate meticulously on something.
Look at you trying to hop on Than's idea.
It wasn't going to happen, period. So.
See, we should do it with the mouse traps. We should do our own game of Operation. Bring in those mouse traps again.
And he has to pull the cheese off the mouse trap very delicately. Yeah, that is a good one.
Do we have any of those mouse traps around? That one guy gave us so many fucking mouse traps. No? All right. Well, he's going to play Operation. And you also bought another game for him?
Yeah, just in case you guys get bored of Operation, we have Jenga.
So. Yeah, Jenga would be a little rough for him to play.
Just since you mentioned Operation, he started getting a bit nervous, hasn't he?
Yeah.
He's freaking out a little bit. And if he fails, what happens?
Well, we subject him to a song that features jump.
A lot of
another jump song.
A lot of jump.
Because when he hears the word jump enough times, he has to jump.
Yeah.
It's one of those things that he has to do.
No, he doesn't. Look, he's not jumping.
I'm really trying to control
it. See, he's not jumping.
Jump. Using it, man.
Jump. No,
see,
jump. He's not jumping. He's constantly jumping.
What's
he's not
jump
jumping.
Thing?
Jump.
You haven't heard the jump
no,
thing
man.
Yet.
I've been out the country.
Jump. Oh, man. Leave him alone.
Jump.
What's the jump?
He's eating his nose right now.
Jump.
He's real.
There he's going.
You are joking. Is he doing that on purpose? No. That is
jump.
Amazing.
Jump.
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 Wait, he doesn't even know what it is, first of all.
I'll explain in a second, man. You just jump.
Uncontrollable jumping?
Dude, he brought a friend, right? What a great friend he has.
Oh, like,
we're doing all the stuff we do with Twitchels usually, and we're taking a break, and this guy comes running up to me and whispers in my ear. He goes, dude, say jump on the radio. I'm like, why? He goes, he can't control himself. If he hears jump, he has to jump. I'm like, get the fuck out of here. So we tried it, and sure enough, he lost his mind. So then we played Jump Around, that song Jump Around, and he lost his mind.
Imagine on a minefield, it'd be funny, wouldn't it?
Jump.
What the fuck?
See, but I can control it sometimes, but for the most part, I can't.
Don't even challenge us with that.
Yeah, jump.
He's slowly losing it.
Wow.
He's slowly starting to hop.
Sometimes, man, I have this blast of, like, God. where this is so mean.
No, this is the best match.
But it's like just a second of like, oh my God, just the abuse. But it's like it all comes to a head, and you feel better when he goes, I sold out fucking, you know. What else can you do? That's the price you pay for fame.
Right.
Is you get abused, and then you sell out your shows and your fucking fame.
First of all, let me tell you right now, I wouldn't be here if I didn't, if I was offended. I mean, I had the best time whenever.
Yes, you would.
Whenever I'm here.
Yes, you would.
Come on.
You shaky, pluggy motherfucker. He's the plug in his mind. He came in here the first time with a fucking children's book. Hey, I got this.
Shaky, pluggy.
Pluggy, shaky Jumping bastard. He's like, I wouldn't be in here if I was offended. You wouldn't be in here if you was offended.
No, Patrice, I grew up being 300 pounds having Tourette's. I'm beyond the point of being offended.
You could be 300 pounds.
You know that.
I can't believe that.
First of all, you were here those times. You know that. Yeah, I was 300 pounds.
You used to weigh more than Patrice?
I look twice his size. I was 300 pounds. Because I was like 5'10", 5'11 at the time.
He showed his stomach. Remember that? He got like pregnancy body. Yeah,
well, because I lost 85 pounds, that's why I have all the loose skin. This is all the skin I got.
Oh,
and
damn,
it's like...
Bro.
That is the worst six fuck I've ever seen.
But then again, that's how...
Horrendous. He has this fucking six baby stomach and fucking C-section.
He's got the lasagna
scars. He got the lasagna and the C-section scars.
That was horrendous.
So, this nigga got ovaries. He's this
ovaries.
Sing queen of the night.
Old. And that's exactly.
Old crepe paper abdomen.
Oh, my.
Well, if it wasn't for this skin, I wouldn't have got on Leno. That's how I got on Leno, doing belly ball.
Wait, what's that again?
Belly ball is what I did to get on Leno. I stick a wiffle ball bat underneath all this loose skin, and I can hit a wiffle ball if a T-ball stand. They featured me on Steve Harvey's Big Time doing that also.
Should we do it on our show?
Yeah.
I remember seeing that.
Can we do that on our show? Or?
It was on a segment called Don't Try This at Home. NBC flew me down to do the Tonight Show for that, and it was fun. You know, I figure I have all this loose skin. The reason why I found out, I was writing one night, and I dropped my pen, and I couldn't find it, and it got rolled underneath the fat, and it was holding it there.
Jesus.
But, you know, it's who cares?
Are you going to get the operation eventually?
I don't have insurance, so it's like I can't
afford
it. Our
pal Big Kev's getting that exact operation.
My mom just
lost all that weight,
week.
And now he's getting the loose skin removed.
Well, my mom had the gastric bypass surgery about a year and a half ago, and just last week she finally got all the skin removed. She just got out of the hospital on her birthday last Friday, and it's all gone. They removed all the... And they said it's really life-threatening. So that's why I don't want to... I'm too nervous to do it.
Yeah, that's a, like, ridiculously dangerous surgery.
Well, if you figure, my doctor even said, if you look at this right here, they said I'm really...
Have to?
It's like the worst thing I've ever seen in the morning.
Yeah, God gave me a shitty hand.
It just looks like a clam that somebody knifed out of the shell.
Yeah. Oh, God.
let's get...
Like a raw clam guy just...
Let's get Sharpies. We can make faces and stuff on that.
I can do an old person's ass when I do that.
Let's see that.
Do girls like that? Oh, I mean, have you met girls that like that?
Yeah. Oh,
no.
I mean, I'm stuck with it. What am I going to do?
God dealt you a seven-deuce offsuit. God damn, man.
The fluff was nothing.
Yeah.
It's a flop full of color. This is for anybody who listens and goes, oh, that's just fuck. It's like, what else? Like, hip, Big A, what the fuck else would an obscure version of this mess be? Like, it's like, imagine him not being on the radio, being fucking verbally abused, and he's walking in the streets without a fucking radio program out there.
Yeah.
Hey, why don't we have an open call for more messes?
Messes.
Just a mess, right?
Yeah. Next Friday, open call. You just show up at the station if you think you got something to offer this program, like Twitchell's
no
does.
No less than
and
three
Big A.
Fucked up things.
What about
Big A is,
missing
Big
limbs?
A is hideous.
I say we do it all, man.
Missing limbs.
Open call for freaks a week from today. All morning long.
No lie, man.
All morning long. We got the mic set up, and you come in if you think you got something for this
Cleft
program.
Pallets.
Wow. Anything. If you're brave enough to show up with your
all Stacey
with
Keaches.
Your mess,
bunch of Stacey
like freak
Keaches
and
Keech
like
Marins.
And Eric Roberts, a bunch of Eric Robert face motherfuckers.
Yeah, and we'll be like
Joaquin Phoenix.
we'll be like American Idol. We'll sit here and we'll judge if you're if you're a mess or not.
Oh, you're the worst.
Yeah. Because Big A is another mess.
Get that up on the website. A week from Friday, we do an open call. Open
Big
call
a
next Friday.
Is, a lot of
is,
people in
is
right.
A bum.
Just a mess.
Just a horrible looking individual, and he has. It's like you're double cursed. At least double cursed, Obi. Not. It's just like, oh my God.
But what is triple cursed? Really?
He's only double.
Here's the deal. It's going to be an open call next Friday. You got to get past the people on the street that are going to judge if you have anything to begin with. Then you come up here. Okay. Then you see us, and then we'll discuss.
What is it?
Gavin, you free next Friday?
I'm on the panel.
Patrice will be here.
American mess.
I'm going to be pulling up. American mess.
That's right. Dead serious. Get it up on all the websites. We do open call a week from today. You just show up. You're a mess.
And who would you put him in like, say, your all-time three messes?
He's pretty good.
He's one of our greatest finds.
It's the Tourette's and the weight loss that left the belly.
Half a Hulk face would be
oh,
right
half
there.
A Hulk
if he had any type of personality.
Any personality.
What about Big A?
Big A's right up there.
You know, that's great.
Massive
this kind of
right
is
now.
Like American Idol because they can't just be a mess. Half a Hulk face, like you said, perfect, but no personality.
You've got to give him like, the numbers as well.
I like your half a Hulk face, but your personality is not what we're looking for American mess, so I say no.
It's fucking awful.
Coming on nervous.
Yeah.
Sorry. Get this up on the website immediately.
That's
open call.
Fantastic.
The show's called American Mess. Next Friday on the Open
mess.
Anthony program.
Dog, congratulations. You're going to Newark.
Hey, dude. Patrice could be like Randy.
Dog. Yo, dog. Hey, you a mess, dog. What you say, Paula?
You're kind of a mess.
What are we looking for?
Dog, I was feeling that mess.
I say, look.
I don't say you have to have more than. You just have to be a mess, whatever that is.
Well, I mean, come on.
You could have a missing fucking limb or.
Twitchell's? If he was fucking the guy who played Aquaman on Smallville, you know what I mean? If he's like the guy, like they put on a poster as the best looking dude in the world, and he was Twitchell's at his problem. He's fucked up, man. He's
right.
In deep shit. But he not only has this Tourette's, a severe case of Tourette's. He has a horrendous figure. Like, his figure it's almost as disturbing as his fucking Tourette's. And Big A, his look.
I feel great about myself.
Is as disturbing as his fucking speech impediment.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Like I said, half a Hulk face is disturbing. But it's like.
Half a Hulk face. Who is this guy? Who the hell
but
is
like you
this
said,
guy?
Twitchell's at least he's a comic.
Big A's got the lifestyle,
special.
Too, that just like is a mess.
As a cab driver. And he's.
And I think all this should be considered,
yes,
but it shouldn't keep you out if your lifestyle isn't that bad.
It's an absolutely open call, just like
Let's
American Idol.
Guy comes down without a leg. You'd think everyone, you know, but it was, you know, hacked off in a combine accident.
And he didn't have health insurance, so he had to just duct tape it up.
Yeah.
Now, a duct tape, a guy missing a leg with duct tape on it. That's a fucking mess.
I don't know if you guys noticed that I have two different color eyes. I just thought I'd throw that out
Jesus
there.
Jesus Christ.
I was born with
like
heterochroma.
A cat.
If you look right there, one eye is half green and half brown. And I was born with it. It's called heterochroma.
All right, someone needs it, like 8 megapixel cam.
You're also born with
put
heterochroma.
Put it an inch away from that eye and snap that picture. Let's get a real good shot of that.
Jump, hold still for
the picture. That's going to work.
Who the fuck said hold still?
You idiot. It's going to be a fucking Picasso photograph.
I can't believe that jump thing, though. Still
jump!
It's amazing.
Jump!
Jump.
Oh, yeah, now he's losing it as far as the jump thing goes. All right. So, listen, American Mess next Friday in the Opie and Anthony program. Open call. Doesn't matter what you got.
Yeah, whatever problem you have.
Amazing.
Anything. I mean, you have the wacky voice, you're missing a limb, you could smoke cigarettes from your vag. We don't care what it is.
An industrial accident, maybe you had a bolt shot through your head.
you get creative with it. If you think you got something for American Mess.
American Mess.
Next Friday on the Opie and Anthony program.
So that's England.
Wow, we
did music and everything.
Steve will make promos and everything.
Oh, man, I can't wait.
The promo should start running immediately on this fine
channel. Steve's good like that.
If you're coming down on Friday, if you think you already have something, give us a call. We'd love to hear what you think your mess.
I can't even wait for that. That's amazing.
All right, Twitchels. We're going to play Operation with you in a little while.
It makes you feel uncomfortable, doesn't it, man?
Hey, and we'll bet on the Operation game. That's what we'll do.
That's a classic.
What's going to be the conditions of the bet?
How long
before he buzzes?
How many body parts do you need?
I'd say none.
But other parts are harder than other parts. Remember when you was a kid playing it and the wishbone was the easiest
the
one?
The hardest is the rubber band.
How about
the funny bone was
band was real hard.
I got it. We put the body parts in a hat. $10 a man, you pick out your body part, and that's the one you're hoping he could get out of the body.
All right, that's good. It's very random.
It's like a Super Bowl box.
Take out wrenched ankle.
Right.
And it was a wrench. And then the rubber band was, what was the rubber band?
I think it was...
It was called a body part. Someone will get it on instant feedback. That's okay. That's the best thing about instant feedback. Because they all had, like, weird names. The funny bone.
Well, we might have different names in England, you see.
Stack, and then they had the ribs.
Hey, people are suggesting they vote for American Mess.
Open it to the public.
We'll get video clips of everybody. That's a great idea.
That's
awesome. That's the third round.
Isn't that the final when they vote at the end who's
that's
the best?
A great idea.
At the top 10.
And then that person, whoever wins American Mess, will be part of this program, obviously.
We met
Big A just on a sidewalk one day. Twitchell's was brought in by Big Tab. So I guarantee whoever wins American Mess will be a featured player on this program.
Yeah, I think we ought to give Half a Hulk Face another chance. Look at him.
That dude is dead.
Look at him.
Oh, shit.
Look at Half a Hulk.
Wow, oh, my God.
Look at Half a Hulk.
He's got a fucking sticker on a golf ball.
All this shit's on opieandanthony.com.
And does he talk? Does he talk with that? Can he talk?
He was boring.
Can he talk?
He was boring. It's like half his body went to Jupiter, and, like, the gravity just fucked it up and then sent it back.
The nigga got mad. He was just a little bit mad. He just went, all right.
If this guy could sing like Frank Sinatra, we would be off anymore.
I'm just a little angry.
Look at him. He looks like, my God, his ear's dropped.
His ear is down on his neck.
Yeah.
I think that's a good point that they have to have something special about him other than just appearance.
Well, it'll be up to them.
It looks like he's been to the dentist all
afternoon.
Because
you know what? Half a Hulk Face, even though he gave us nothing radio-wise, he's given us some great fodder on this program.
Yeah.
You don't know what it's going to be.
Very memorable.
Yeah, you got a point.
Once again, open call next Friday. You just show up. It's American Mess. I'm opening at the program.
No rules.
No rules. No holds barred.
If you're a mess, you're a mess.
That's right. American Mess.
Right after the O.C.
I can't wait to see the criteria.
Right
after Dancing with Retards.
On ice.
Shitting with the Stars. That's what... And you guys just go, dog. Dog. And then the guy goes, what? No, I'm just saying you look like a dog.
A dog. You're dragging your ass on the carpet, dog.
Dog.
Dancing with Retards.
American hey, we might have to do that, too.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Good.
All right. Well, Twitchells, go relax if you can.
Go and sit down.
All right. True Boogie, you just hanging today?
That's funny.
You got any remixes in your blood? You might have to do It's Raining Stuff, you know. Anthony was suggesting that yesterday.
Oh, my God. If you could kind of mix to that.
I heard a little bit of it today. I'll check it out and see what I can do.
Tourette's rap?
Oh, that'd be funny. Very good.
The Tourette's rap could be funny, too. All right. Anyway, we should take a break. We got Gavin in the studio. Do we have your buddy's audio? We love playing it every time you're here.
You know what? Man, I think, Steve actually took a re-record of it, so I believe he does.
That is so goddamn funny.
It is funny. You know what? You should speak to the guy because he's even funnier. I mean, he's a great guy. I mean, I'm not going to lie. He's funny as hell.
Great guy.
He's funny as hell.
He took a strap-on dildo up his ass.
Imagine stories. I mean, his things he's done are amazing.
And there ain't no mistaking it.
No,
when you hear it.
No, he's...
Oh, oof.
Gavin,
You were in a hotel room with your buddy and this, was she a skank? I mean, was
she... No, it was a swingers party, and she was at the swingers party. I mean, these swingers, they're a lot of fun. There's no, you know...
And what is your job at the swingers party? Just to sit there and laugh?
No, my job was...
She's got the greatest laugh. Gavin has one of the best laughs.
To take video.
And your buddy's getting it up the poop chute by this chick in a strap-on, and all you have is the camera phone and your laugh.
That's it, man.
And the guy's never done this before.
He has never.
He just
done
figured
it,
it was time to have a woman strap a dildo on and tag him in the ass
it. As I said before, it's a filthy weekend anyway. So I mean, I saw a lot of things that weekend that, you know, after a bit you just stop being surprised.
Yeah.
I mean, 8 o'clock in the morning and your pal's getting fucked in the ass with a dildo. Well, you know what? Hey.
This audio.
You gotta enjoy it, man. You gotta enjoy it. I'm a big fan of it.
It's hard to hear it. At first, but then it's very obvious.
Oh, it's so obvious when he gets it.
And when he gets it in the poop chute and the laughing that...
I could not hold myself together.
How could you not?
Dude, it was hilarious.
All right, let's take a listen to this. This is Gavin's friend getting it up the ass by some chick with a strap on. One of my favorite clips that we play from time to time.
Fucking hell.
Patrice, we're going to do our own Web Junk 20 show. We're going to get our crazy clips and have people vote on those too soon.
Funny, man.
Oh, man.
No. I love it, man. It's funny. I mean, it's one of the funniest things I've listened to in my life about a day. So.
I don't doubt it.
That is really good.
It's my buddy behind him that's behind her that makes it work, you know. It's hilarious.
Yeah, you don't even know. It's like, you see the video? It's like this guy's getting fucked in his ass by her, and there's a guy fucking her in the ass. and the guy is fucking
hurt. Oh, my God.
This is why it hurts
his
him.
His thrusts are blasting. So that's why the guy's going, oh, because this guy, you know, is fucking her like an animal and pushing her
he's
into
he's pretty
him.
Much fucking him.
Yeah. Right.
By proxy.
Yeah. By proxy. Yeah. Right.
Wow.
We should get the video up on the website. You want some downloads?
I can't do it, man. I can't do it.
No, that's okay.
I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry.
It's all good. You've shared enough. It's all right.
I made that. Giving out some good friends there.
That's great.
I'm sorry, man.
All right, why don't we take a break, and we'll continue. We got Gavin in studio, who's just a friend. I don't even know how to, like, introduce you.
That's nice.
You're a friend of mine, too.
I appreciate that.
And everybody else now. Twitchell's will be playing Operation in a little while.
Can't wait.
Can't wait for that.
Can't wait for that one.
And bam!
Other stuff on the way. Yeah, we'll play
you
America.
Took my funny bone.
Gonna kill the batteries in the game before the show ends.
You took my
a little sing-along because we were talking about Osama and an American mess that's coming up.
Osama, is he back out? Is he bringing more videos?
Yeah, a little audio tape, yes.
No, he's like Puff Daddy, isn't he? I mean, he's got them all, hasn't he? Like, hey, I got a new video today. What's going on? Fucking brilliant.
And look, look at the press he gets when he drops a new
amazing.
Album.
He's got more tapes than...
does he talk this time, or is he just rapping again?
He's got more tapes than Notorious B.I.G.
Yeah.
More remixes
he's
coming out.
You've got to love the guy, man. Yeah, he's the best. He's the best hot and seek I've ever known in the world.
He really is.
All right. We're going to play America Fuck Yeah in honor of that and an American Mess. All the details will be up on the website soon, but we're dead serious. Once again,
yep.
Open call next Friday.
Oh, God, what?
You show up and we're going to find
out who is
the American Mess.
Queuing outside there.
I'm hoping.
You better get a club soda in, man.
And we're going to have like the prejudges out there going, you're not met. You don't, you're not enough of a mess. You're not enough of a mess. And then you got to walk away all bummed out because you thought you were a mess.
Your confidence levels go even lower.
Only the biggest messes will be invited up to the studio and then we'll go from there, okay?
Hilarious.
Right. American Mess coming to the Opie and Anthony program. All right, the info for American Mess is up on the website. Open call for all freaks for next Friday. And we got to get Ben in here. He's got a prize, a really good prize.
Ah, see, that's what gets the people out.
For the best two messes we look at next Friday. I think we're going to have to do open call every Friday for a while because this is going to take time because I think people have to, you know, build up the courage to come down.
Yeah.
So I don't think this is going to be a one-time thing, but we'll start next Friday. We'll see what happens. But for Friday, Ben, what
top
do we got
freaks,
for
freaks? Lingerie ball, L.A. Bowl, L.A.
Whoa.
Wait, round but that what about the women freaks?
Huh?
Oh. Yeah, well.
Well.
What about the girl
trip to L.A.?
That's a trip to L.A., so don't go to lingerie
trip
ball.
To L.A.
The heterosexual women freaks.
You think, all right, how many women freaks? You think we're going to get down here? Freak women.
You'd be surprised, man. I've seen a lot of freaks out here.
Look, if we get a really freakish woman and she's great and she wins the damn thing, trust me, we'll
it's
figure out.
It's a trip to L.A.
And we'll figure out something nice for her if she's that bummed about the prize. Don't worry about it.
They put you up somewhere?
Yeah, hotel,
put
airfare.
You up, nice hotel. You got, the airfare. You're there in L.A. You get to see the lingerie bowl.
Two trips to the lingerie bowl courtesy of Bodog.net, right?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Come
and that's
on.
Super Bowl Sunday halftime show. You get to, you know, be in the audience to check out the lingerie bowl.
Not being unappreciative.
Plus, you get the trip to L.A. It's a great prize.
Not to be unappreciative.
Yes.
But here's a question.
Oh, Jesus, Patrice.
I just want to ask. Okay.
Feel free.
All right. Is it two trips for two? Those trips are two trips, so it's four people can go all together.
Yeah.
Right, four.
You and a friend. Right. Two you and a friend trips.
I just like to say, is there a fucking horrible human being who's going by themselves to the lingerie bowl?
Right.
All right, get that up on the website. So there's the prize.
That's the real prize.
Two trips to L.A. to see the lingerie bowl for the two biggest messes we see next Friday. Open call when we do American Mess.
Now, you know there's going to be a couple of American Messes that come in here, and we just go... Thank you. And they have to leave.
That's going
to
be the best part.
Is because they're not going to be messing up.
Their whole lives, they've had this thing on them, and it doesn't impress us.
No. It could be like an Aaron Neville mole or something.
And don't forget that none of the messes, like Twitchell's, he doesn't know he's a mess. Big Kev goes, hey, come on, let me talk to you for a second. I'm going to bring you on in. Yeah. He thought he was coming in and go, hey, I'm a comic. So real mess is like, you're going to get the guy in the blue bunny suit that comes, yeah. that came yeah. down.
I remember
just like,
that guy.
Get out of my fucking face.
Thank you.
But then it's like, you're going to get, like, some mess is going to be coming with people who go, hey, let's come on down. They're not even going to know they're on American Mess.
That's what it's going to take is yeah. people that listen that know a mess
right.
and are going to go, hey, why don't we come down? We'll check out this radio show Friday.
Yeah.
And they're going to bring the mess and bring him in. And
by the way, I'm a little nervous because not one phone call from a mess.
Hmm. Of course you wouldn't get one.
They're out
just,
there.
They're sitting there going,
where are the big A's and the Twitchells?
There's a guy there going, I can't wait. I can't wait till next week and see who's the mess.
Working himself out.
Yeah.
No one wants to be the mess.
This is a great idea, but I don't know if it's going to work.
Guy's like, that's going to be funny radio. With all those fucking weirdos.
There's going to be people sitting there. I can do that. I can be more. I'm better than him. I'm more of a mess than he is. No.
Yeah. And they're going to get thrown right out.
Ah, well.
We got...
Ozone midget sighting of the day.
Second midget sighting in so many days.
Who saw this coming? Let's say hi to Rick in Florida. Rick?
Yeah.
What's up?
I was calling about the midget sighting. I saw one in Big Springs, Texas.
Isn't that weird, seeing a midget in Big Springs,
Texas?
I thought so. She was... wide as she was tall.
Badass?
Just a little fat midget.
Oh, God. Felt like kicking her right down the steps.
Well, what was she doing? We'd love to find out what the midget was doing when you saw him.
She works, I guess she works cleaning showers out there at the truck stop.
Oh, good God.
She had a little tiny bitch.
Wait a minute. Did he say truck stop?
Yeah.
How did she clean trucks with a midget?
The pieces are falling out.
It was bad.
Oh, my goodness. One fell in your lap.
Yeah.
You're breaking it, Drew Boogie.
Yeah. We're going to play Operation a little while, Drew Boogie. All right, Rick, that's about all you got?
Yep, that's it.
All right, thank you, sir.
Meanwhile, back at the show.
Let's say hi to Matt in New York. Matt, what's up? Oh, my God, you guys are killing us on the phones today. Let's go, Matt.
Yeah, what's up?
What's up?
Quick question. If I bring the mess to you guys,
yeah.
do I win or do they win?
Well, that's the deal you got to make with the mess.
Interesting.
They both win.
Oh, fuck him. He doesn't know the difference.
Yeah, like, if you bring a mess, it's a trip for two. There's two trips for two. So if you bring a mess,
what if someone brings, like, a Terry Schiavo, and they have no idea?
Oh, wow. That's an instant winner right there.
All right, guys.
You have a friend that has something different, or what?
He's missing a leg and missing an arm. His whole right-hand side of his body is torn off. It's pretty funny.
How'd that happen?
It's pretty funny. How do you say that about your friend?
It was actually a motorcycle accident, but it's pretty fucking hysterical to see him try to get around.
Is he willing to come in?
I have to call him and find out.
All right. Well, we'll see what shows up next Friday.
Wow. Yeah, this
see you guys next week.
All right, thanks,
This
Matt.
Is the only way that the message is going to come in is that their friends...
Help them out.
They go, this is a mess. And they can't even tell them, hey, you want to go on American Mess? What are you trying to say? No, I'm just saying there's a show called American Mess, and I was just going to say you want to go down there. Why? Why? It's because, it's just saying.
It's a guy that used to call our show. He got hit in the head by a boat.
Oh, yeah.
Holy shit. And he survived.
No, he was in another boat. And a boat ran into the boat he was in, and the hull hit him in the head.
He would be right up there as far as winning this contest.
It fucked him up.
We haven't talked to him in a while. If he's out there, maybe he could call the show today.
Is he still coherent? I mean, can he still talk?
He's pretty fucked up.
Yeah. Oh, shame, steel plate in his head.
And all he wants to do is get laid, because it happened when he was like 17. What happened?
Oh, not for you. That was for Gavin.
Why?
There's a whale in this dumb river in England.
This England.
It is
this
dumb river.
Beautiful country. It's an actual sea.
Sorry about that.
For you. Northern Ireland. Northern Ireland. No, it's not.
All right, let's go to Rich in Virginia. Rich?
Yeah.
What's up, Rich?
Hey, I just want to know if you and Patrice were going to get to the top 10 rap song breakdown today.
Oh, you know what? Patrice is going to be in next week. We'll do the top 10 rap songs like we did the country songs. We'll do that next week.
Try to figure out what they mean.
I like them.
Yeah. All right, we'll do that next week because we got to play Operation with Twitchells for some money. Ooh, and also, I want to take a peek at...
It's in Thames?
Huh?
So two whales are in London, the London Thames.
Look at, you see how he tried to play? I pointed, I tried to be quiet about it, right? I pointed, he's like, oh,
that's the most important story to him.
Fucking
oh, it's a whale in the Thames. And trying to get him out.
He's always trying, I go, everything in England I point, I just go, hey, guy, there's something going on at home. And he tries to go, oh, Mace, what are you fucking think I care? You think I care about my homeland, Mace? And then it's like, after the fucking, after you make me look like ass, he's just sitting there going, oh, whoa, fucking pushing a whale, look at him.
Who is this ridiculous guy that's like splashing at the whale?
It's a Greenpeace.
Well, the whale isn't in a position to do anything there.
Real country must be boring.
Let's go to Bill in Vegas. Bill, what's up?
Hey, I was just thinking a good tip for the messes that come in next week. You know, be prepared to Trump your mess. You know, be able to take it one step further. Like the guy who brought in the dead monkey. You know, it wasn't enough that he brought in the dead monkey, so he stuck his dick in the monkey's mouth.
That's right. Anything goes with this.
Wow.
I mean, and use your brain. You know, I think people are thinking just one way, well, I got to be missing a body part or something. Absolutely not. You might have some crazy, weird talent.
Trump your mess.
I like it, Bill. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Before we play Operation, I want to take a peek at this this new show I'm into big time.
Yeah.
Beauty and the Geek. Anyone watching this?
Haven't seen it.
Holy crap. You get these tens, these women, and you get these just uber geeks that have barely kissed women. One guy holds the record for, like, solving the Rubik's Cube the fastest.
Hey, well, there's a
prize.
He
does it in 12 seconds. He can do it behind his back, blindfolded, all this crap. And these guys are all, like, rocket scientists.
How does he do it?
And they're
blindfolded.
Well, there's a pattern to that.
Yeah, but how do you know when
you just got to know when to stop.
Oh, Christ.
So he looks at it, and he knows how many times he has to do the pattern, and then that's all it comes down to. So it's studying the Rubik's Cube and knowing, all right, I could do the pattern for, you know, 10 turns here, and it's going to work, and then he does it behind his back.
How fast? Pretty fast?
Well, the world record that he holds, it's like 12 seconds or something. He solves the Rubik's Cube.
I was never able to solve one of those.
I can do two sides.
Fucking
two
room.
Sides. Like,
yeah, you get like, all right, I got two sides.
Right.
Stupid thing.
And then you got like a guy who's a Dungeons and Dragons guy. He's a dungeon master. And another guy that's studying like...
Well, he's the master? Well,
he's a dungeon master.
Wow.
And all these guys are from, like, MIT, and they're just ridiculously smart.
Yeah.
But their social skills stink, and that's why you got the hot women. So they learn pop culture and how to dress and stuff from the women and how to be more of a man. And then these guys try to give these dumb bimbos some intelligence.
Hmm.
It's a great show. They live in a mansion, and then they do these things.
Of course.
And at the end of the show, they couple up, first of all. I guess I should explain the concept a little better. The geeks, one by one, go outside to the pool, and all these girls are just lounging around in tiny, tiny little bathing suits, and the geeks have to introduce themselves, and then the girls decide after the geek leaves who wants to be paired up with that geek.
Ooh. And is there, like, the last person picked geek?
Well,
like in
they avoid
class?
That because it's one at a time, so you never, you don't, I guess technically you would know, but you don't get to see all of them at once.
They should do that line
and
of
one
just
guy,
really degrade them.
There's one guy, maybe we could get the clip if Danny's listening, of this guy that looks like Woody Allen that has anxiety attacks when he sees women. Absolutely loses his fucking mind and goes outside. He sees these tens in bathing suits and he can't even talk.
Hot chicks in bathing suits.
Because he's just a geek. That's all he knows in his life. He doesn't get a chance to even socialize with a girl above
Very
a two.
Very nervous.
Yeah.
That's your boy.
Attractive girls.
Right. So then they.
That's the dude from Family Guy, right? Was that Family Guy?
Oh, he looks
he's
a lot
on there
like
now,
that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there was another guy that has kind of a Napoleon Dynamite, feel to him. So then the girls decide, well, I want that geek. And then they get a room in this mansion.
What?
And now they get to live together in this room as they're doing these challenges and tasks and stuff.
Wait, do they sleep in the same room?
They sleep in the same room.
Wow. Not the same bed.
Some have only one bed, but the girls are already skeeved out, so they're putting up partitions and stuff. But the Woody Allen anxiety guy that actually takes medication because he freaks out when he sees hot chicks, he was in a room with one of these girls. He goes, I cannot sleep in the same room with someone as beautiful as this girl. So he took his stuff and he slept in the closet.
That's probably a good place for him.
Peeping Tom.
No, he's not gay at all.
Not
the
gay.
Guy just cannot handle being in front of beautiful women. He doesn't know how to act.
What did the girl do? Was she laughing about it? Was she cool about it or what?
Yeah, most of the women are cool, but you could tell they're like, oh God, I gotta make believe I care about this geek for like you 5 or 6 weeks. Yeah.
Well, why not just take the situation you're in and be weird rape guy? Just like go from the geek. Because you're weird anyway. The girls are looking at you like you're fucking, you're weird.
Right.
Be weird rape guy, where now you're just grabbing women and shoving your dick in them.
Yeah.
There you go.
It's a whole new show there.
I showed you.
And then some of these geeks are like delusional because they did, you know, the girls want to hang out at the hot tub with their tiny little bathing suits and stuff in between challenges and tasks. And this one guy did not want to hang out at the hot tub because he thinks he has a great body because he works out. And they show him like flexing in front of a mirror.
Oh, no.
And he's far from having any type of body, but he's so delusional. He's like, look, if I took my shirt off around the girls, you know, the other guys are going to want me kicked out of the house because I'm obviously better looking than the rest of them. It's a great show. I'm enjoying the shit out of it. It's called Beauty and the Geeks on Thursday nights on the WB, I guess. So we got some quick clips here just to go over of Beauty and the Geek. All right? The ladies get their tasks. Listen to this.
Ladies, you, however, are going to make a speech. You may be comfortable using your looks to win people over, but can you use your knowledge of current issues like the environment and politics and the economy? We're going to find out.
I'm a senior in college right now, and I'm in an international marketing class. Marketing might have something to do with politics. Maybe not. I don't know.
I don't really like politics. I don't like knowing what people's views are because really I don't really care. Whatever works for me, I guess, is best.
And these girls are like, you know, models. And one girl, all she is a cocktail / shot girl. That's her profession.
Oh, shot girl. Okay.
Yeah. So they're just as dumb can be. So they have these tasks. This one, obviously, is to show their intelligence, which they don't have. And then they had the guys do, like, singing karaoke, something that they are just not comfortable
doing. Yeah, they're
doing
very introverted. Because
they just don't go out.
Yeah.
So the task here was discuss these hot topics in front of an audience too. So now the next clip is one of the girls discussing the ozone layer. That was her topic, discuss the ozone layer.
Oh boy.
And then the audience decides which bimbo did the best job, they win, and then they don't get kicked out of the house. Her and her geek don't get kicked out of the house.
All right.
Here we go. The ozone layer.
So ozone layer is key because that's what keeps the sun rays out. If the sun rays get in, they call it the greenhouse effect. Have you heard that before?
It keeps the sun rays out, but the sun still gets to us, but it keeps the harmful things out.
Yeah, that it's like a protective layer in the air.
Or else we'd melt.
So here, or else we'd melt.
God bless you. God bless.
See, I forgot. This is this is them practicing because obviously the geeks have all the knowledge and they're like,
yeah.
They're practicing with their women. This is what you need to say. You need to understand this is what the ozone layer is about.
Yeah.
But they can't grasp anything. Or you'll melt. Here's
melt.
One geek helping his beauty about Social Security, because this might be one of the topics.
Okay, Social Security. Oh, we just talked about this in class the other day. Social Security, isn't that what you get when you're older? For some reason, I don't know why, but they're afraid that it's going to run out. Like, because, okay.
I think my partner is probably not going to do very well with her speech.
No, I know something. Normally, at first, I was like, what is that?
I thought maybe she had a few blonde moments, but apparently her life is just one long blonde moment.
This girl
and the geeks get so fucking frustrated because these girls are so stupid.
Oh, I know.
And
you get old.
Right.
Yeah, great.
And the hot pieces of asses get frustrated because these guys are just messing.
Yeah.
So but that's the hilarious thing, that their vaginas equal these motherfuckers' brains. Like,
Yeah.
It's an equal power.
Right. Yeah. But it's like the same end of the magnet. Like when you try to put them together, the north and the north, they just push apart of equal strength, but there's no connection there.
Yeah. Does pussy really trump genius?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yep. I'm sorry, mate. It does.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess so.
I mean, they can be so thick sometimes, it's great.
A good piece of ass will get anything she wants.
As good as.
Yeah. And then a genius guy.
Well, if you get a smart bit of ass, it's really nice.
You're going to get. What's the guy going to get, though? for being a genius.
So that was them practicing, and now it's time for the debate. Now they got to see which girl is the best at, you know, soaking in this knowledge and spitting it out to an audience. So the first girl here is discussing taxes in front of a live audience.
We're the only country that didn't sign this thing called the Kyoto Protocol.
Like the Kyoto Dragon.
I'm sorry.
Oh, my gosh. What? She didn't say like the Kyoto Dragon.
Yeah, well, this is one more clip of them practicing. I'm sorry. Listen to this.
We're the only country that didn't sign this thing called the Kyoto Protocol.
Like the Kyoto Dragon.
Cheryl seems very stubborn to take my advice when it comes to studying.
I think I'm going
to
take a power nap.
You're going to take a power nap? You're going to take a power nap?
Yeah, this reading is making me tired.
But it's been like 5 minutes.
5 minutes. That 5 minutes was more than she's ever had as far as her brain working.
She was not.
And she needed a nap.
The concept
of the show.
That's what Bill Gates says.
Yeah.
I got to take a power nap, but he's inventing the world and shit.
Yeah.
I'll be right back.
The concept for the show is just brilliant.
The
because
Kyoto
these guys,
Dragon.
These guys are taking it so seriously because, you know, their intelligence is on the line, you know?
Yeah.
What did I win? I mean, what does the geek get?
$250,000, the last couple in the house.
Okay, gotcha.
So finally, here's the girls debating after they had their geeks, prep them. The first girl discusses taxes.
Your question is, do you support lower or higher taxes, and why?
I believe my view would be for the Democratic view in this situation. I feel that people who are more wealthier should definitely have higher taxes. Let me collect my thoughts. I'm sorry.
A little change purse.
I know I'm trying to look smart right now in my suit, but it's kind of hard.
The whole problem with Danielle's speech thing was that we did a lot of practicing for the karaoke competition, maybe a little too much.
I felt really good about coming here in this like really cute outfit with my pink shoes and my pink top, but it's really not giving me much brain power. I feel that that my suit is cute and that I'm wearing hoops like J-Lo.
She could not
have nothing.
Taxes at all.
She had
all.
Nothing. She had no opinion on taxes.
Back to South Bend on shoes and handbags.
Except what she heard.
Well, that's the
tax
best part.
Tax the rich.
That's the best part, too, because they dress them up to make them look more intelligent, too. Man. When all they want to do is wear the tiny...
Oh, what do they put them in, those Hillary Clinton suits?
Pretty much.
Now, do you think women... There's a woman out there, a beautiful woman, who gets anxiety attacks when she's around, like, smart people. And she's just like, there's geeks. She sounded like she was getting one, but they have to be proven to be like that. Like, you have to, like, there's never a point in time where just in regular society where you go, you know, you're beautiful, but you are a fucking idiot. And she's just like, oh, my God. It's just like, it takes this kind of thing
if
for her
she's
to just...
If she's at a cocktail party with intelligent people, not one of them is going to walk up to her and go, well, how do you feel about taxes? That's why she's not getting an anxiety attack in front of, like, wealthy, educated people that are in a room, because they never would approach her with something like that.
Right.
Yeah. But they put her in the situation in the show, and she loses her mind.
Right. All right. And now...
collect her thoughts in a thimble.
Now, here's the first girl that picked pollution as the topic. You have to pick a number, and then the host tells you what you have to talk
pollution,
about.
Pollution, bad. What are you going to say about it?
Dirt.
Well, they bring it to a whole new level.
Oh.
What do you think about pollution? Dirt.
Okay. Just keywords. Like she's giving clues for the $25,000 pyramid. Dirt, air, smokestacks, things that pollute.
Here we go.
Jackass.
Jennifer, what would you do to prevent pollution?
When I heard the question, I was like, ooh, this is great. That was the one she took the most notes on. That was the one she sort of like hammered in.
Well, let me start off by saying that there are three types of pollution. There's air pollution, water pollution, and land pollution. For the speech, I just knew that I wasn't going to remember all the information that I learned. The way that I can prevent air pollution is maybe not eating a lot of gaseous foods when we're farting a lot. That's a form of air pollution. I just had to start picking up stuff in my head and just, I don't know, making up stuff.
Oh
my God. I don't know what I was doing up there. I was just talking. Everybody just do your part. Reuse, reduce, recycle, whatever with the slogan is or whatever.
Use, reduce, recycle.
Is that an airhead niggly?
Yeah, sounded like
an Arab black girl.
Yeah.
Oh no!
See, there
wow.
So,
fuck.
So this equal opportunity shit is supposed to be dumb blondes, not a dumb black girl.
So here we
farting
go.
Is really the problem we got with the air
eating
pollution.
Gassy food.
Then here's the second girl that came up and also picked pollution to talk about.
Okay.
Tristan, your question is, what would you do to prevent pollution?
Crap.
I can't tell you the exact numbers. If we keep acting and doing things the way we're doing them, it's going to be bad. Turn off your refrigerators tomorrow and let's revert back to the olden days. Let us go out into the woods. Start picking berries.
As soon as I knew I kind of had the audience with laughing, there's no turning back. It's just like, all right, I'm going to go with this.
For the reason our ice caps are melting.
The audience seemed to love it. The audience was laughing. I didn't know what they were judging on. I had no idea.
Stupidity. Ice. Your stupidity.
You're the reason the ice is melting. You know what? The ice melting is always fucked up. It's always been a pollutant.
Yeah.
Melting ice
melting
is always
ice.
A pollutant.
They show the geeks in the audience, and they're just dumbfounded. They get so pissed off.
When you pee in a toilet, really, think about it. Where does it go?
It's water pollution in your toilet. Because it was clear water, and then when I stand up, it's yellow, and that's polluted.
When you take a shower... Now, I took a shower yesterday. So how did I get dirt on me again? See, that's pollution.
All right. Next girl, we're almost done here. I had to talk about global warming.
Uh-oh.
What would you do to alleviate global warming?
Just because I have immunity doesn't mean that I'm safe. I still need to put 101% out there. Okay, global warming. Do you know what? Our Earth is a delicate Earth. I think everybody here is connected, you know? Everybody is related somehow, so your children are my children. I'm finished.
Holy shit.
I'm telling you, these guys are so stupid.
No, that was by far the dumbest answer out of all of them so far. Global warming. We're all connected. Your children are my children. That's what she said.
See, my children are warm.
Why?
And the beauty of this show, you know, these girls, you know, obviously it's not smart to play dumb because they want to win the money in the end. They already got on the show for being dumb, so now they're trying to show how smart they actually are.
So they really wanted to.
Yeah, they really want to sound smart so they win this this task or challenge so they don't get kicked out of the house. Because they want to win the money eventually.
She didn't even try.
So, who picks them off the show after that? I mean, is it the audience? Is it all the...
Yeah, now the audience has to decide which girl did the best. Finally, the last girl talked about pollution as well.
What would you do to prevent pollution?
Everything is recycled. My shoes that I'm wearing right now are actually made out of recycled cow skin.
Sarah has a lot of strong points. She's very good at being cute.
When you have kids, you're constantly changing diapers and don't throw them in the backyard because that's land pollution.
You know, people aren't going to take her seriously because she is attractive, so I was a little concerned.
If everyone could just take a small step into pollution, it would make our world a much better world.
A small step into pollution.
Into pollution.
Let's step into some pollution here.
So that was the girl challenge.
Unbelievable.
Your womb is so polluted. Can't even have a little baby.
So just how the show works. So then one girl won. So then her and her geek are safe. And they get to pick a couple that is on the chopping block for the final challenge, okay? And then there's a guy challenge, and the guy challenge was singing karaoke, you know, a social type thing.
Yeah.
And then the guy that did the best karaoke, he was safe, and him and his beauty will not get voted out of the house, but they get to pick another couple to go to the ultimate challenge at the end, which is like trivia, okay?
Uh-huh.
And last night's show, we're just focusing on the women because they were the dummies this week, certainly.
Yeah.
The women had to talk about, had questions on politics, and the guys had questions about popular music. Okay?
Okay.
So we just got some highlights. All right? And I'm watching this with Lindsay, and man, you know, she's one of these girls, love her, but she asked me questions, there's no good answer. There's no good, and I'm sure a lot of people can relate to this. We're watching, you know, the beauty and the geek at the end, the two couples going at it, and it's the two beauties doing questions about politics. And she casually goes, so who do you want to win? You know, we invested an hour in this show, so I guess that would be a normal question, right? I'm like, so she asked me, who do you want to win? So I pick the one girl. She goes, why is that?
You can't win that one.
And you can't win, right? And if you don't answer, then the thing is, well, why won't you answer the question?
And what is it you like about her? You don't like about me.
Right.
Where's that one girl?
So I got killed last night because I obviously picked the hotter girl. Yeah, that's the only reason. I don't know it from a hole in the wall. I'm just watching this dumb show. So if it comes down to it, you're obviously going to pick the one that's hotter.
Of course you are.
Is my ass fat while we watch this show?
Yeah. You don't fancy me. You like her. We're watching a show again. Never.
What? Proving that my chick is very, very smart.
Let me ask you this. To the girls,
so I answer, and then I get killed. I'm like, duh.
Was she the hottest one as well?
The one
that you picked.
She was one of the hotter ones. Sure.
Now, did the girls on the show, did they argue with each other as well? Did they hate each other? Did they slag each other off?
No, they're supportive of each other.
Oh, they're all girls at arms.
Yeah, but it's probably all bullshit.
It's even worse.
So I got myself into a position last night because I answered one of those impossible questions. There's
you
no
can only wish
right
that
answer.
She gets voted off the show and then you'd be safe.
There's no right answer. We'll have to do a whole show on our women asking the questions that there's no answer to.
Yeah.
That's when you need the ejector seat in your couch. You pull the handle between your legs, the segment of your roof comes off, and the chair goes. Parachute lands you safely miles from your home.
That's where I wish I could get explosive diarrhea on where I could just call on explosive diarrhea. Love to answer that, but I have to hit the bathroom.
That's what you wish you could have, like a big A and just have time to answer.
And I wasn't even thinking. I'm like, it's a good question. We've been watching the show for an hour, so I go her. Amanda, I think it was. Why?
Why?
Well, because I think she's smarter. All right, anyway, so finally it's the two women talking about politics. We got a couple highlights here. Listen to these answers.
What is the address of the White House?
I just told Amanda this answer. I just told Amanda this.
What?
I just told
1600
Amanda.
Pennsylvania?
1600 Pennsylvania!
1 White House Road.
Come on.
Washington, D.C., United States of America.
That's a good
guess. I'm sorry, that is incorrect.
White House Road. Makes perfect sense.
Where's Osama bin Laden live? 36 Blow Your Ass Up Boulevard.
Next to the big mansion on the left hand side.
Oh, my God.
And you hear the guys yelling. They're in a soundproof room yelling the answers, you know, hoping that they...
White House Road.
And remember, they want to be smart because they want to stay in the House and win the money. So this is them trying.
You know, it
Where's
it
John
isn't.
Wayne live? Gun Street?
Huh?
What, bitch?
Yeah, it isn't 1 White House Road, but it should be.
It should be. That's the
why isn't it?
Stuff that should be.
Why is it fucking 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue?
Where are whales from? Atlantor? What?
From Whale Land.
Wales.
From Wales.
Wales. That's right.
Tough is out there.
Let's go to Chad in Buffalo. Chad.
Yo, what's up, guys? I was watching that show last night, too. My girl asked the same question. As soon as I said the girl I wanted to win, I was like, shit. She sat up, gave me that look, and I'm like, yep.
And you wanted Amanda, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because it wasn't even close as far as the hotness factor.
Yeah, well, I didn't like the other guy, but, you know, that girl was hotter, so I was like, yeah, I'll go with Amanda. And she's just like, what? And I was like, shit.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Yeah, sometimes you get blindsided. You're not even thinking. You're like, yeah, I'll answer this question. It's no big deal. It is a big deal. Fuck!
The only thing you can do is pick the girl nearest to what your girl looks like, just to remotely get out of it. You know, she got blonde hair like you, baby.
Matt in Boston.
I can't believe you guys didn't figure this out. The right answer is, honey, I don't care who wins. I like watching these stupid cunts get eliminated.
It doesn't matter to me. I'm not rooting for anybody.
That's right. I just think it's fun to see how stupid they are. All right, here's the next question.
What American historical figure has his face on a $10 bill?
All right. Thomas Jefferson?
Holy cow. That is incorrect.
That's not the easiest question in the world, though. That's
Alexander
not one of those.
Hamilton.
But that's one of those.
I think that's an obscure one. It's not like Lincoln or Washington.
Yeah, I think half of us would have got that wrong in this room.
I should have stopped the tape.
I'm with Allwood.
I'm going to tell you something.
Well, you.
Come on.
Every bill's got that fucking queen on.
That's what I'm saying. It's easy to get money. Okay, who else is on the pound note? The guy who invented the trolley. this is why I hate these stupid countries.
Listen, money's good, man.
We have a theme. Dead president and the White House on the back.
Yeah.
Their theme is the queen and some obscure asshole.
We've got the queen on the front, and on the back is a lorry.
Dude, we have famous inventors and things like that.
Famous inventors.
The queen and Sir Jonathan Schugelman.
Who invented the tube.
He invented drinking back in 1960.
Exactly. Winston Churchill.
He should be on there, actually. He's not on there, I don't think.
No?
He should be on there.
Yeah, let's go to Paul in New Jersey. Paul.
Hey. Oh, but you so pussy wimp that you can't tell your girl that you think the chick on TV's hot?
Thank you, sir.
No, I'm not.
Thank you, sir.
Absolutely, I'm not going down that road.
I like this guy, man. Don't fuck that to the guy.
That fucking road.
I say off the air, on the air, stop this shit.
No, why?
Who would you vote for? Well, I would vote for that girl. Why? Well, because I would love to fuck her.
Fuck. Trace is a swinger. It's okay. You can do that.
I would love
to. Don't you want to fuck her too, sweetie? That's why you get with a bisexual.
Yeah, let's call her over right now.
That is a fantasy world that most guys don't get to live in. Know why, Paul? Because I don't want to know who she thinks is hot.
See, that's our problem.
I don't want to fucking know.
Man, we got to get over that shit, Opie. I don't want to know. It doesn't matter who she can get him.
I don't want to know.
It's a mind thing. Just say, hey, because I want to fuck. Well, what if I wanted to fuck the geek? Knock yourself out. I hope he has a big dick. I hope he fucks your bladder loose, baby. Go get him, Tiger. Women don't when we don't care, they don't function well. Just don't care. Let her fuck a geek. Tell her I want to fuck this hot chick. Well, I want to fuck the guy who plays Shaggy in the Scooby-Doo movies. Well. Make him wear this fucking Shaggy fucking wig and fuck the shit out of him, Pumpkin.
Call me crazy for not wanting to play that game. I just don't want to play that fucking game.
Thank you, Paul. Fucking guys, man.
Fuck that. All right, here we go. Here's the last question from last night's Beauty and the Geek.
What is the capital of Iraq?
Ooh, not going to get that one.
Could you spell Iraq, please?
What? There you go. Get that spelling. Take some time there.
I-R-A-Q.
You shouldn't say Iraq town.
I'm going to go with Afghanistan.
Oh, my God. That is incorrect.
There should be a test. There should be a test that allows you to be an American citizen. Yeah. And I don't mean the one they give you.
Who are we at war with?
Because it doesn't matter. That? They study for that shit. It's like, yeah.
Can you say that in a sentence, please?
We're at war with
Iraq. Afghanistan is the capital of spell Iraq.
Spell Iraq. I-R-A-C-K-E with a hyphen over it.
What? French hyphen.
Well, guys always looking at my rack, and that kind of rhymes with Iraq. So I got to say nipple. Dumb brush.
Spell black. B-L-A-Q. What?
Close enough, you piece of ass.
All right, John in Michigan. What's up, John?
Hey, my wife asked me, I suck. I'm punching out soon.
All right, he punched out. His plane is in flames, but he is slowly coming down to earth. He didn't crash.
His wife asked him the unanswerable question, that's all.
Yeah.
That's all. The point I was bringing up, no matter what relationship you're there's those questions that are asked, there's no right answer.
Unanswerable question.
I fucking just. Never mind.
Not for Patrice.
Never mind.
Patrice.
Never mind.
Let me tell you something.
People are going to think that I'm fucking some bullshit motherfucker.
No, you're just.
This is a credit to you, my friend. You are a rare breed.
I've got to say.
You are a rare breed of guy.
He's a pimp, man.
Like the way you treat women, the fact that they don't run for a court to get a restraining order or some shit, it astounds me.
No, he's not that bad.
That they don't spend a day with you and just go, fuck this shit. Like, they just stay. So you got some kind of magic and philosophy
that
works.
Right.
It works for you and the women you're with, and it's amazing to me.
Opie has to understand when they ask that question.
It's not just Opie.
I'm just saying Opie for purposes, but it's...
I'm not alone in this one. I know that.
Okay, yeah. The Opies of the world, I'm saying.
But see, guys don't ask the unanswerable questions to their women.
Wait, that's the point.
It's a female thing. They ask us the unanswerable questions.
That's the thing. We enable it because they ask and they know that they're fucking doing it.
Patrice answers.
That's what... So if she goes, she's asked, okay, always think, even no matter what tone she has, always put this tone in your head. So, who would you vote for? Even if she goes, so honey, booby scooby, honey squirts, who do you vote for? Always in your head go... Who the fuck you like? Which bitch you want to fuck? That one right there, ho. I like the fucking shit out that girl right there. Any other questions? Just ask. All right.
Yeah, sit back and shut up.
Holy shit. Opie, you understand? That's the trick.
There's more Opies than our Patrice in this world. There are more Opies.
I like where I'm at right now. Oliver in St. Louis.
Wow.
I'm fine with where I'm at. Oliver.
Hey, man, don't you guys live Beauty and the Geek every day when you go home after work?
Oh, that's a piss of money.
All right. Why don't we take a break? On the way, we got Ted. Ted Alexandra. That's right. He's a very funny comedian. He's going to come in and help us with Twitchell's playing operation, I guess.
Yeah. Wow.
Twitchell's plays operation next, and we're all going to bet. And also, we got a food plug on the way, I guess.
Food?
Right?
Ooh.
Yeah, we got free food today. We went to break and Patrice just went off.
It just keeps going.
Frustration, man.
Want to say hi to Ted Alexandro. He's in studio as well today.
What's up, guys?
Sorry to make you wait, but we're in the middle of a huge fucking thing there.
Yeah, no, please. Clusterfuck.
Now, what did I miss? I left the studio and I came back to a huge laugh.
The conversation was still going on about relationships, and I've been stunned by Patrice's relationship. I talked to him about it even at the Halloween party and stuff, and I don't understand it. I don't get it. I don't see how it works without it being this dominant motherfucker and this subservient, scared woman.
No.
But he says, no, that isn't it. But everything he says describes a dominant, subservient relationship.
And I'm not talking shit. And Gavin sees, it's like my girl is not, I'm not fucking some evil motherfucker. It's like my happiness is paramount. When you see a happy woman, that means there's a miserable guy. When you see a happy guy, it's a happy woman. Because we have to keep them happy. And I'm like, this is not my job to fucking keep you happy. Oh, why don't you treat me like a queen? Yeah, I will. The king's bitch. That's who the queen is. That says it all.
That's a tremendous
line. Treat me like a queen. Okay. You're the king's bitch.
That's what a queen is, the king's bitch. And she's not no scared. It's just she tests me and tests me. And so who do you, ready? Sweetie pie, who you want to win? Always in my head, so what bitch you want to? Here's how I reverse it. Ready? Who do you want to win? Ready, sweetie? Who do you think I want to win?
Ooh.
Then she points to the bitch that she knows I will fuck. Now, next time...
No, that's not your woman.
She knows the women I like. I like big, fat bitches, right? So, my girl doesn't get threatened by fucking other beautiful women like her. She gets threatened by big, ugly, fat bitches. Wow.
He does as well. He does. He will sign
the... And she'll point that... Ooh, the one with the soggy-ass titties hanging out. Yeah. And you knew it, ho, before you asked the question.
You are in bizarro world... Absolutely. You are in a bizarro world relationship.
Drew Boogie knows, baby.
That's why I was in Jersey.
Yeah, Drew's talking all kinds of shit the same way Patrice is. The whole commercial break.
In your relationship, is there any equal ground at all? Or do you have the upper hand in every single thing?
It seems like the only thing that she has over me.
There's no equality in your relationship.
She can leave and get any guy she wants to fuck her.
Yeah.
If she wants to... that's the only thing I have to detach myself
from. We've seen her. Now, if there's a problem and she goes out that night with the determination
with
that... fuck this guy, I'm going to go fucking... she will get fucked that
night. She is.
She's not like some pig that's going to go out to a bar and 5 in the morning have to pack it up because she can't get fucked.
That's where she wins. But other than that, there is not a drug. And it's not because I'm trying to. It's that I'm smarter than her. I'm quicker than her. It's just. It just is what it is, dude. It is what it is. She was crying the other day because she felt inadequate. But I'm like, don't cry, sweetie. It's not.
Why do you think she feels inadequate?
Look, first of all,
why do you think she feels inadequate?
Maybe because he goes on radio saying that he's smarter and quicker.
Right, because because a man named Patrice O'Neill is with her.
My king, you bitch. I'm the king, bitch.
You motherfuckers don't even know.
I don't.
The only one who understands that it's not evil is Drew. Because you gotta stop, man.
He's a brother.
What a coincidence.
I think it's the mentality of the brother.
Fuck.
I think it's the mentality of the
brother. American brother. It's different.
Yeah.
The English guys are completely different.
Because we want happiness. I take care of this. Look, man.
Now, what you said earlier, during the break, he said, and it in this sick way, it makes sense, but it's so twisted.
Absolutely.
He said that the good part of this whole thing is that he chooses to be with her. He chooses to love her.
Yeah.
He's not obligated to
it.
And the second he starts taking shit from her, that means that he is obligated to love her and be with her.
It means he lost the power.
That means I volunteer my love to my girl. And if she takes that shit for granted, then I take my free love away. And I freely give her.
You are the black Dr. Phil.
Dude, man.
You really are, man.
There's nothing that says we owe a thing. I don't owe her nothing. Her job, because I keep her more happy than she keeps me. All she has to do is fuck me and shut her face and stay pretty. I don't need nothing else. I gotta guide the bitch. I gotta give her money. I gotta give her. I'm that dude for her. I'm what she needs. I'm what she wants.
You're gonna be back to the whores in Rio before you know it.
Why do you have to put the word voluntarily at the end of I love you? You know, like, isn't that understood? Like, I love you.
No, it's not voluntarily, understood, Ted.
Baby.
No, man.
No, because a lot of guys, they chase after the women, and they're it's, Jesus.
It's like,
hold on. I'm going to get to the words in a minute.
I know what you're saying. See, now, Ted, this is not personal business, but Ted has a lot of sisters. And like 5 sisters or something like that?
No, I only have 2.
He's grew up with sisters, and you love them?
I love them.
Love them. I
have 2 sisters. It's like, I don't have...
I love
make
I love
it sound
them.
Like he has 12 sisters.
Voluntarily, I love
him. I had a lot of sisters, but it's like...
I might have.
Yes! That's what you got to understand. Love is not something that that anyone's owed to, man. There's people out there that don't love their mama.
You're not supposed to be pressured to love anybody.
Danny Glover, color purple motherfucker.
No, man. No. It's like you should. Love is a free thing, man. It's not something that you're supposed to fucking do.
Yeah.
Someone earns your love, man. If my mother loves me, I earn her love. It's not an obligatory thing. It's like you go, damn, I want to love you. I want to love my girl, but she got to keep me in that mode.
Do you know something, though, that there is a part of love, and some people see love as in a loving relationship as some form of sacrifices because you care so much about somebody that you're willing to give up a convenience or an emotion or something because it would make her feel happier, and your love is so much
for
that person.
Here's the point.
Okay.
The way we treat our women, we have to constantly, because they are a different animal. Well, now when I say fuck me, be quiet, what I meant by that is that's all I fucking need. Don't bug me when I don't want to be bugged. You have your list of things that you don't, that it's fucking so easy for your girl not to get on your nerves. So easy. And you might have 4 things where you go, if I had a chick like this, I'll be happy. Women, not only do you have to make them happy and keep them happy, you have to be fucking creative. You never had your girl go, well, let's do something tonight. Let's go somewhere. We never go nowhere. Where you want to go, sweetie? I don't know.
It's up to you.
You don't want to do that work.
We have to be the ones that constantly help nurture them and love them and keep them happy.
Feeling
the enemy. Feeling Come here, silly. You don't understand, man. And I'm not like that, dude. I've never hit a woman in my fucking life. I've never even...
Not physically. Sounds like there's a mental battering going on.
Well, sometimes, you know why? It's the... Okay, how men chase pussy... Mm-hmm. That's how women chase our manhood relentlessly. It's not even a focus. It's a nature. They don't want a pussy ass man. It takes you down anytime you enable them when it's not natural. Like that whole question, who would you fuck? You okay? I can go. Perfect example. I'm going to bed one time. This is my ex girl, uh-huh. And she goes, "What side of the bed you want to lay on?" Okay, this is the shit that it. Here's where it ends for men. When you ever get that gut feeling of this fucking bitch, but you don't say nothing, okay? Where it ends is where you don't say nothing. So she goes, "What side of the bed you want to lay on?" And I go, "This side." And then she goes, "But then I won't be able to see the TV." And so I go, "Well, bitch, why the fuck did you ask me where you want to sleep anyway?" Now, I could have went, "Okay, I'll just sleep on the other side." But that was some enabling shit that she wanted. Women are not humble enough to go, "Can you?" They want us to be chivalrous, but they want to force it to happen. But they don't want to, like,
so
instead of saying,
"I like this side of the bed," "I like this side of the bed, is that okay with you?" Or whatever, to be nice about it. It was, "What side do you want?" So that way, when you say this, the side she wants, she could then turn her around.
It's manipulation, and you've got to understand it. It's
do you ever get a full night's sleep, or you guys just go back and forth talking about who's going to get it?
I missed the show.
Because it ends like that. So
I just see it as so strange.
And then you know where the happiness starts to happen?
Where?
Enemy.
The happiness starts to happen is when she starts to think, okay, is this righteous? What I'm getting ready to do. So if I am I asking my man a righteous question when I ask him who will he vote for? So she says, "Hold up. All right, this is some bullshit ass manipulating girl shit I'm about to ask. You know what? I'm not going to ask it because this asshole is going to make me suffer for asking bullshit."
That's fear and walking on eggshells.
Good. Fuck it. If you want to call it that, good, bitch. And right, you know what? Listen. I bought you some soft boots so those eggshells don't fucking hurt so much. Fuck you.
All right, listen. You're going to be in next week. We're going to have to talk about this more because you hit on something. The phones have exploded.
I love
it. We have Twitchels outside the studio. We got to end with this game of operation.
I am fascinated by your relationship.
It's simple. He treats
and it isn't even something that I don't understand. Like, I understand what you're saying. I understand the words. I understand everything. I cannot see it working out. It's like some kind of a fucking Einstein theory that can't be proven in real life. I don't
victimize. I'm not a predator when it comes to, "Oh, I'm going to find some weak woman." Da, da, da. My girl's not a weak girl. I've been out with doctors, lawyers, fucking journalists or whatever the fuck, and they're all goofy. They're geniuses, but they're goofy because they're girls. And it's certain things we do that this because they're girls they're going to do, and it's certain things that we do because we're men. It's just, it is what it is. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you.
I love
it. We're running out of show here.
All right.
Got to say hi to Ted Alexandro.
What's up, guys?
You performing anywhere?
Sorry, Ted.
I know.
Actually, Patrice hit on a lot of the things I was going to say.
Yeah.
Clever, man. Clever.
It's a crazy day to come in. Are we promoting anything today?
Yeah, I'm at Gotham this weekend. Gotham. The new location, 208 West 23rd, Friday and Saturday night.
Right. Ted is a very funny guy. I've seen you many times. You make me laugh.
Thanks, bro.
And also, Ted is the... Should we say?
Yeah.
He's the co-leader of the Comedy Coalition. In New York City, him and
really?
Russell Neve, yeah, they put it all. He did it twice. He put his actually Ted is the fucking the man because he put it together twice. Once by himself, and then he got smarter the next time and got some other people to go down with him just in case. But he pushed a lot of stuff. We getting more money and a lot of shit.
Yeah,
in New
stiff
York
arm some of these club owners.
Yeah, because of Ted and
it's
Russ.
It's amazing how much these guys don't get paid when they're just in town, you know, doing their thing.
Russ is funny too, man. What happened?
He's a good man.
And that's Twitchell's. He has Tourette's and he's a comedian.
I met him outside. Yeah,
yeah,
good
we were
man.
Talking outside. You have a half hour special coming up with Comedy Central.
Thank you, brother. Yes, coming out March 10th.
That's
awesome.
Yeah.
That's a positive response, I guess.
That's what we're all going to say.
That's translate.
That's Twitchell's approved.
Oh, cool, man. Cool.
Twitchell's approved. Well, every time he comes in here, we have him do stuff, and we got a game of operation that's set up
and ready to go. We're going to bet, though. Who wants in?
I'm in, man. I'm in. I'm the book. Yeah. I'll take it.
Want to do $5 or $10 a man?
Five.
Try five. You can always, you know, go up to the next level. And
so how are you going to work this? How many times can do it when you without blip, buzzing?
Well, basically, we got the operation in front of you. And all the body parts are in there already?
Yes.
It's all set to go. So we have to pick out the body part from a hat again.
So the elastic band is on the thigh bone, is it? Is that what it was?
Huh?
Oh, it is. That was the thigh bone. There you go, yeah. The shin bone or the thigh bone or something?
Femur.
Don't go practicing.
Yeah, don't practice.
Put that goddamn thing down.
I know, believe it or not, of course I know the game. I never played it before in my life. No, never.
Me and Patrice are in there.
No surprise.
All right, I'm in.
So right,
here we go. The fives in.
You want to throw me a five back? I just got a thing.
Yeah, there you go. Throw that in there.
Thank you, sir.
All right, so basically...
it's time, isn't it?
I guess Nathaniel should just, like, hand out cards to everybody.
Oh, is this for the body part?
It's $5 a man.
Yeah.
We're all going to get a body part that Nathaniel just randomly gives us.
Okay.
And then one by one, Twitchell will try to get that part out without making it buzz.
Now, the only way to also make it fair is after we get our body part, we have to remember it.
I can write it down.
Yeah, we'll write it down.
Just hold the cards
back, shuffle them up, and then have him choose cards.
Gotcha.
So there's no particular order.
Oh, that's a good idea.
What about if you have the same body parts? Split the pot?
I'm in.
I'm in.
Yeah, we'll split the pot.
Patrice
whoever.
Is in.
I'm in.
Yeah, Patrice is in.
Ah! Whoa! That's a Tourette's.
13 parts? How many people?
Seven.
Seven? Yeah. All right. So we'll just deal with those seven?
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
So Nathaniel is... all right, who's in?
The guy, look at the guy in the corner. He's completely out.
Pass him out.
Skits that. What's happening?
Ten of diamonds.
Yeah.
Six of clubs. Ace of spades.
Hold on. Ted, you in?
Yeah, I'm in.
All right, Patricia, you're in.
What are we looking at, Ben?
Hold on. Gavin's right. In. Who else? I'm missing somebody.
I got a weird card. I need a different card.
I think it should be secret, too.
This card's not even
mine. You want to keep it secret?
Take this part
so that way when he does it or doesn't do it?
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
Okay.
So what are we betting?
We're betting money, my friend. We're betting American dollars.
Who, what part he's going to successfully remove and who it corresponds with.
Oh, fuck. I got a good one.
I've got a grill.
I got a good one.
I might have
shit.
I have a good one here. All right.
You got my funny bone.
So what do you guys want me to try to do? The object is to not touch the sides, right?
That's the object of the game there, Twitchell. The game is 50 fucking years old.
I've never played it.
The object is to take those tweezers, remove
man,
the
I got a,
part
I got a good
without
one,
touching
man.
The side.
You also
okay,
have
so
never
you
built
me to
a house
get as many
of
them out without touching the sides as I can, right?
No. We all have parts that are going to be ours.
So how do we determine which one I go for first?
Anything you want.
No. Nathaniel,
he gets them back now.
But yeah, we're gonna hand the cards back,
and he picks one out while randomly.
And then he's down.
Okay, so I'll randomly pick one
randomly
out, and that's the
pick.
One I gotta go for.
It's
wait, aren't there enough cards where there's double? No, there's only 13 cards.
Yeah, we'll just do seven. It's all right.
Just do seven.
I'll just put the seven back in again.
All right, Nathaniel's writing down in everyone's body part.
And if he successfully pulls that body
you're
part
all mine
out,
down,
you're in the
you
game.
You win the money.
If it's not successful, then you're out of the game. And then after the round, we'll see who's left. And yeah, they'll split the pot, I guess. He's not going to get one, I don't think.
No.
He's going to get mine. I don't think he's going to get one.
My bone owls.
I don't think he's going to
so
get
one.
So
what's like the widest one here? Is it like, which one is it?
Well, I lost it bandsaw.
It doesn't matter. When you're shaking, everything becomes just a small little...
Yeah. Thank you for reminding
you
me.
You can fucking play Operation with an actual giant.
Life size.
Chopstick tweezers.
Walk inside of them and it'll still buzz.
You're trying to get those tweezers in the Grand Canyon. You're not going to be successful.
Don't touch the side of the Grand Canyon. Fuck!
I can't believe it.
I've never played this game before, but I think I can handle it. I think I can
what
handle it.
What did you do as a child? Did you not play this game as a child?
Dr. Twitchell,
I've heard of it, of course, but I never played it.
Dr. Twitchell's into the operating room now.
No.
Dr. Twitchell. Go ICU, Zach, code blue.
That's actually really funny. 2020 did a special on a brain surgery when I was Tourette's.
We don't care.
Okay.
He's only trying to break into a heartwarming story about a
single.
I'm not heartwarming.
Just single patient Terry Schiavo.
No, I just think that's ironic.
All right, no practicing.
No practicing.
All right.
And we got to mic the board. Do we have another microphone?
Dr. Twitchells. That's funny.
Dr. Twitchells.
That is funny, mate.
All right, Nathaniel, I guess.
Dr. Twitchells, please report to the microsurgery ward. Dr. Twitchells, you have a LASIK eye surgery needs to be completed.
Dr. Twitchells.
Oh, yeah.
Now, as a kid, I remember as a little trick, you could just take the battery out so you could cheat. So this makes the battery working. You just touch the red bit there,
yeah,
and it's working.
Let's hear it.
There you go.
All right, there you go. All right, we ready to play?
I can handle this.
Seems to be you to say.
Well, you got to take the mic from this mic.
No, we got to mic him, too. You got to mic him.
You got to put some kind of mic.
You got to mic the guy.
Oh, God.
Wait, now, we need somebody else.
What
E-Rock, we don't need you over here. Mike Twitchells.
Is he going to pick a card, is he?
Yeah, oh, yeah, he's okay. Going to pick one of the seven cards.
We should announce when he picks who he's playing with. Because they got to be able to play along at home.
Yeah.
All right, pick a card, Twitchells.
Yeah, the office is swinging in this time.
All right.
What you got?
What's the part?
It says Breadbasket 1000.
That would be Danny. You're playing for Danny right now.
Playing for Danny. The bread basket, which is the
slang
word
for
his stomach. No chance in hell.
That is a tiny little...
Well, remember, the bread basket was easy because you had the handle you could pin onto.
Yeah.
No.
All right, here we go. Pick up those tweezers.
And even if he gets this one, he's got to run through all of them, because if there's a tie, if he's able to remove two.
That's right.
But it's all the way towards the left.
You got to use the tweezers to move it around.
Yeah, you can move it around.
Here he goes.
Yes, switch out. Ow! This is very tedious. How the hell am I supposed to grip it?
Moving around a lot.
Get in there, son.
Holy Jesus.
It's amazing to watch. Oh, no way.
Shaking like crazy. Is that thing working?
What the hell?
All right, here we go.
Here he is. You can't get a grip on it. Oh, Jesus, the whole board's moving.
He can't use his hand to rest on.
He's trying. You gotta see this video.
That's operation.
Oh, secure.
Oh, wow.
He got it out.
Got out the bread basket.
Oh, he even turned it around a little bit.
Wow.
Oh,
Danny.
I'm sure this game's working.
All right, that's one.
Yeah, touch the side of the bread basket thing. Oh, wow. You really got to make contact on that thing, huh?
You really got to touch it, yeah.
Bastard game.
He just cursed the game out. It's fixed.
All right. Dip it in water.
What's the next part?
All right. Here we go, Twiffles.
All right. So far, Danny's got the cash.
He just failed the perfect.
Wrenched ankle.
Hey,
no
that'd be me.
Way.
That's Anthony.
No way. That's coming out of there, baby.
Which one's that one? Is that the bottom?
That's the bottom of the desk.
Yeah, it looks like a wrench.
All right, let's go.
Okay.
It's the bottom left foot.
Let's go, Twitchells. He's playing operation. Don't wrench touch the board. Ankle.
Oh, we're not allowed to
You can't.
Oh, well, he was leaning on the whole board the whole time with the fucking bread basket.
I'm leaning on the countertop. Yeah.
Now take that.
Wow.
Yes. He told you, motherfucker.
Jesus. Aggressive on the microphone, isn't it?
Here we go.
But it's all the way, like, it's all the way.
Shut up and do
it. Just do it.
Enough.
Oh, God damn it. Holy shit.
Fucking amazing. Is his face?
The shakiness.
His face.
He just shook like
a... You can't say jump either.
All right, here we go. He's going for Anthony's.
I know it's not possible, but the little animated character on the board looks even more scared than he did. I don't know if I'm just imagining that.
Come on, Twitchells. We want to...
Yeah,
we want to finish this game before we get out of here for the weekend. Here we go.
I think I got it.
Damn it, I knew it. You fucking twitching bastard. Get that fucking breadbasket.
Buddy, that ankle is a bad motherfucker.
I knew when I saw wrenched ankle I was screwed.
Anthony's out. The next part.
Damn it.
Ankle. Butterflies and stomach.
That's mine.
Butterflies.
That's mine. A hard one. It's a weird shape.
Yeah.
You know what I liked is when he hit it, he looked like a doctor that just lost a patient. He had that like really controlled.
Now, no rest in your hand.
Yeah, you gotta come high.
I'm tired of that.
All right. Here we go. Come on. Come on, Twitchell.
You can rest your elbow on the table. You just can't rest your hand on the board. And I think that's in the rules.
Right there, right?
You can do it.
Come on. Come on. You can do it. Let's go.
Oh, God.
Oh, he's gone, man. He's got no chance.
He can't even get near the hole there. He's twitching like a bastard.
His construction's gone completely.
Yeah. He's... The first one took it all out of him.
He did.
Come on!
Oh, Jesus.
Come on! I'm
so out.
You know those ducks are like the sponges? I can do this. Yeah. I really can.
All right, let's go, Twitchells.
See, you gotta get
I have
the
all the face.
Head. That's what the key is.
All right, let's go.
Oh, my God.
He's gone.
Come on, Doc.
Doc, you can do it.
Come
on, Doc. There you go.
Take long. Holy
you
shit.
Took my funny bone.
The go. Fucking morgue is filling up down in the basement of this hospital.
Water on the knee.
That's me.
Oh, right, Patrice.
The there you go, Twitch.
Isn't that
go,
the
baby.
Bucket?
It's, I think it is.
It's water on the knee.
I think it's a bucket.
It's a bucket, yeah.
Hey, baby, the big easy
now,
one.
That thing's all like shoved up halfway.
Hey, whatever. No, you gotta get in there,
just
move it around.
Slide into the middle and get it on out by the handle.
Yeah, Patrice is right. Finally being nice to me.
Oh,
He was so nervous when the truth was nice to be dropped the needles.
He fucking...
I was so
fucking right, man. There's no
that
fucking
is,
way.
He picked the card. Oh, he knew it was. From that time, from the time he picks the card and says what it is,
that's
game time.
Oh, noodles. That's the way it is.
All right, well, do you think if the doctor drops a fucking scalpel into some guy's open wound?
Listen, we only have 3 minutes left in the show.
It's game time for brain freeze.
Oh, it's me, man.
It's up top.
We guys, believe it or not, speed this along because we're running.
Twizzles, don't drop this.
All right, come on.
I'm trying. Fucking wanker!
What a wanker! I can't believe
being
walk away with
ankle bone connected.
Oh, that's Drew Boogie.
So the key to this is let him
careful now
to be the first one.
It's a rubber band.
Ankle bone is the rubber band that is wrapped in there. It's pretty tight. It usually winds up pulling the tweezer. After you get it off the peg, it pulls it into the edge.
This is a commentary. This is a commentary. Brilliant.
Here we go. Hey, one hand. Double-handed technique.
He can do whatever he wants.
Yeah, it's free hand.
Can I use two or one?
One
anything
hand.
You want.
Just
anything
do it.
Oh, shit.
All right, here we go.
Oh, he's going to do it.
He's got it.
Oh, shit.
Got to get the end bit off.
He got it. Damn.
No, he's still got to get the other bit off as well.
But he's
don't look
it.
At me. Just look at the ball.
He got it out. He got it.
He
had the runs. You got the rubber band is out.
Drew Boogie is in.
Oh, you cocksuckers.
Jolly horse.
You didn't give me that fucking...
He dropped it in, man.
He dropped it in
there. Oh, is that hysterical?
Well, Tracy hates you as well.
We're running out of show. This is Ted Alexandro's piece. Charlie Horse. Here we go.
Charlie Horse. All right, where is it at? All right.
It's a tough one.
Will we have three winners to split the pot, or will we have two? Here we go. Twitchells.
Gotta get that end piece. Nah.
It is not
there
looking
good.
There
you go, good. Ted. Let's share a cam. All right.
Start up the Pointer Sisters so we can end this program.
All right,
so we got a winner. We got Danny and Drew Boogie.
Yeah.
They'll split the pot, the $35 or whatever
Very
it is.
Very good.
We're going to end the show with a little Pointer Sisters jump in honor of Twitchell's joining the program.
Wow, Patrice, you got fucked. You got fucked on that one.
You know that was so fucking wrong.
He dropped it right into his knee.
That's so wrong.
Good rule, man.
He
good
just
rule.
Dropped it. That's... But your point was well taken.
What? We got to promote the food. No, where did the food come from? Someone get a mic on him. I want to thank this guy for bringing food. Give the plug.
Woody McHale's. Thanks very much.
Where's Woody McHale's?
West 14th, 234 West 14th, between 7th and 8th.
Yeah, the food was awesome.
Yeah,
go to Woody McHale's if you're in that area.
It smelled nice.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Ted Alexandro, we'll have to have you back when we can really get into what you're all about. But he's a really funny comic.
Yeah, tons of shit.
And he's playing Gotham's this weekend.
Yeah,
right?
Friday and Saturday night.
All right. Yeah, hit that. And Twitchell's, thanks again for coming by.
Oh, what a great idea.
We found out that he has to jump if he hears the word jump. Jump. Jump.
Look at Ted's face.
Oh, God.
Ted doesn't want to bother this fucking It's too fucking funny.
He's gonna stop himself.
Oh, I'm gonna say, Patricia's girlfriend, man. Jump!
Jump!
He's jumping like crazy.
Oh, man.
And that's how we end the Opie and Anthony show. We just ran out of show. Patrice O'Neill, a great week of radio. Thanks. We'll see you next week.
See you Monday.
All right, man.